So, hello everybody. So we are starting the first session today. My name is Konrad Rieck. I hope you had a nice week so far. So and today we will talk about something which is a little bit different from the rest you've heard in the previous days. So I will spend some time with you talking about data mining, or I will say machine learning. There's a slight difference, but actually I never figured what this difference is. But if you go to the Wikipedia entry, you will see there are two different pages. And I don't know what this indicates, but at least I just use those synonymously. So some words about myself. So I'm a professor in Braunschweig. So who knows Braunschweig? Nobody. It's a small town in Germany, I would say. But now that I'm here in Leuven, I would say it's a big town. It's about 300,000 people. And it's very close to Wolfsburg. So who knows Wolfsburg? And why do you know it? Yeah, exactly. So this university, I would say 50% of the university deals with cars, for obvious reasons. So I'm not part of this percentage. So I've been doing security and machine learning for now over 15 years. So it's when I started as a student, even working on this. And I'm now heading a small team in Braunschweig that is working on this intersection of the two topics. If you want to know something about us, you can go to our website and have a look. So I don't want to bore you with the details about myself. Instead, I want to motivate a little bit why we need something else than regular security techniques, or let's say regular fixed exact methods, and why we should introduce something that is a little bit fuzzy and also a little bit difficult to handle. And I have this picture here for you. So I hope you learned in the last days that security is a cyclic process. So this means when you build something, it's called secappdev. So I assume you are interested in building, developing something. The first thing you should do is you should try to prevent security problems. So then you are at the top of the circle. I hope you know that it is extremely difficult, if not impossible, to prevent all kinds of security problems. Simply because at the current time, we do not know all the security problems that may arise in the future. So there will always be some kind of blind spots in the solutions that we develop. And therefore, it is a good practice to deploy detection techniques. So you can think of it as an virus scanner or as an intrusion detection system or any other measure that can help you detect something is going wrong. And then, and this closes the circle, you need to analyze what you found. So it doesn't only help to know there was an incident, or it doesn't only help you to say, well, I got attacked, but instead you want to learn something from this. And I'm not talking of machine learning here, but just you as the developer or operator learn from the incident and then strengthen prevention again. So this is how it usually goes around. Now the problem is, or at least this is my view, in the last 10 years, the attackers have increased their power. And they have started to automate their attacks. So it's not like in the movies, where there are kiddies sitting in front of a computer and typing, but instead the modern attacker is launching a program and then the program will do the job. And a couple of years ago, we had a couple of internet worms. So in this case, the attackers were even able to somehow automatically propagate their attacks through the internet. And today with botnets and spam and things like that, a lot of these attacks are completely automatized. And we also have a larger attack surface. So this is because we are now mixing more and more technology. Yeah? So for example, when I studied, HTTP was just a protocol where you could see web pages. And those web pages were written in HTML. So this is my view of the web. Maybe some of you also have this view. But today, web technology is some own independent world where you not only have HTML and HTTP, but you have a lot of different protocols, techniques, and they're all mixed together. And they're not just living in a web browser, but they're also living in your fridge, in your car, or in other internet of blah, blah stuff. So this means we have a lot of technology, and we're adding more and more to it. And whenever there's a vulnerability in one of these pieces, this vulnerability is automatically integrated into other pieces, right? So if you have a vulnerable web server or a vulnerable web application, and you put it into your fridge, you get a vulnerable fridge, which might not be a serious problem. But And my takeaway from this is that we have more and more attacks, and we are getting bad in detecting these attacks. And we are also getting very slow because we fail to keep pace with analyzing all the new threats. And this is why I made these red lines here to indicate a lot of stuff is not detected anymore. And my view is that the bottleneck here is the human analyst, so let's say the operator or the developer. So in many cases, there's a human involved in this loop. And this human needs to look at the data. He needs to look through the firewall logs. He needs to analyze the detection. He needs to think about what a malicious executable on some PC actually is. And this is his or her task to do this, but it takes time. And if there, let's say, there's an attack per hour or per day, and the human takes, I don't know, 8 hours to do this, then we come in a situation where there's more and more attacks and less time. Also, many of the people doing this job are not actually working for this job. Yeah? So you have somebody operating a network or operating a computer system, or you have somebody developing a system, and his task is actually not to look at security problems. But he has to because it's an important part now. And therefore, there's very little time and a lot of attacks. So my vision here is, and this is why you are hopefully here, is that we might take techniques from the world of machine learning, artificial intelligence, or data mining, and put them into the loop so that computers help us to make the defenses more automatic. And then you can, if you want to, say that you add intelligence to the system. But you can also leave this out, because you will see in the rest of this talk, I'm not really presenting anything intelligent in the term that we actually refer to when we talk about intelligence. Yeah? So I will also show you this later. But I'm very pessimistic about artificial intelligence. Yeah? So I mean, they are very smart algorithms, and they can do their job very well in certain situations. But they are far from being intelligent. And in my view, there's no need to discuss, let's say, the social rights of robots and things like that. So we are so far away from intelligent computer systems that I don't see any problem here. So the idea is applying data mining and machine learning in the context of security, not replacing the human, but assisting the human during prevention, detection, and analysis. And what did I write here? Human out of the loop, but not without control. Yeah? So our goal is not to build something like Skynet from the Terminator movie, which is fully automatic and destroys the mankind, but instead to build something that helps us solving problems more efficiently. So we did this in the past. Maybe I go. So who of you has an academic background, works in research? Some of you, OK. So we are doing this for a long time, and we applied machine learning to prevention, detection, and analysis. And here I have a list of some of our recent papers on this topic. And this is just to get this super cool animation here that shows you we applied machine learning in all of these contexts. Yeah? And I will go into the details of some of these approaches in the talk, and the rest, well, if you look later at the slides, you can check them out and then look for the papers. Okay, so, but to do this, to talk about machine learning, I have to introduce machine learning to you. And I will try this with a little bit of security perspective, but unfortunately, a large part will be the machine learning part. And I think this is super important. So I notice very often, even in research papers, that people use these tools and they have no idea how they work. And sometimes they even write in the papers very, very stupid things. And this unfortunately also gets published at top conferences. But sometimes you read really things where you say like, oh no, I hope they didn't do it. And they did it. So I have to tell you a little bit about what actually is machine learning and why it works and why it maybe doesn't work. And then I will tell you a little bit about the types of machine learning. So what are these types, what you can do with them. And in the very end, talk a little bit about the algorithms. And then this session closes. And I guess you will be a little bit disappointed because there was only so much security and so much machine learning. And this is a trick to get you into the second session, because then we will talk more about security. Yes, but I actually, I thought about how to split this, but to be honest, I didn't want to just do an advertisement show here and say, like, there's a new technology and you need to do this. But instead, I really wanted to show you what this technology can do and whether this is worse or interesting for you. And maybe some of you say, this is not interesting to me. I don't need it, which is perfectly okay. Yeah? So I'm not here on a crusade or so for this topic, but instead just want to tell you about it. In terms of the content, this is a full lecture series. So it's like 15 units each, 90 minutes. This what I try to present in these two sessions. So I will likely run out of time. And of course, if you have questions, please immediately ask. But be warned, so maybe we then take a little discourse and talk about something, and then we slightly lose time. So just please ask. Questions are more important than the stuff here. But yes, and also don't be shocked, because maybe if I'm too fast, then also you maybe say, oh, this is too fast. And if I'm too slow, I'm also happy if you say, oh, we all know this. So who who knows what machine learning is? Okay, so then it will be a piece of cake here. Only the left side. So my experience with students, I mean, you are not students. My experience, if you ask something like, "What is? Do you know topic X?" and everybody raises their hand, this is almost a guarantee that nobody knows what this topic is. It's just that a few know, or a few think they know, and then they're next to them, they think, well, if he knows it, then I also know. So we have to see. Okay, so machine learning in a nutshell. So machine learning, this is what I initially already said, is not about the science fiction stuff. And please get rid of it from your mind. And also, if you open a newspaper, there's a lot of this kind of science fiction stuff written. Yeah? So if you, for example, today, I read yet again about a meeting where they were talking about the ethics of autonomous cars. So you know that autonomous cars need to think ethical in the future, because they need to think who they want to kill and things like that. So I talked with engineers at Volkswagen, and they told me that these cars currently try to avoid accidents as best as possible. And there's no computing power left for making an ethical decision. So until the impact, the car will try to avoid the accident. And then there's impact. And who gets killed is unclear. The car cannot decide. And also, and this is why I don't like this discussion, humans also don't decide ethical in their drive. At least I don't. So I try to avoid an accident as best as possible. And if I'm not able, then I will crash into something. And if it's an older or a younger person, doesn't matter. So it just happens. So try to somehow erase this information about these are better examples than driving cars, self-driving cars. So you know here, this is a T-800 without the skin. Yeah? And otherwise, it looks like Schwarzenegger. So we are not talking about these things, and we're also not talking about HAL 9000. I also recently wrote a proposal with somebody, and they had the strange idea that they need to put this picture into the proposal when they were talking about artificial intelligence. I think this is stupid for two reasons. First, we are far away from such an intelligence, and also, if you know the movie, it's also maybe a bad example for artificial intelligence. Or I'm not sure if it's a bad example, but maybe not for a research proposal. Okay, so now instead, we will look what machine learning or data mining really is about. And if you would put it in simple terms, you would say it's about making computers learn. Well, this is maybe too simple. So what the theory people say, it's about automatic inference of dependencies from data. Sometimes they even say functional dependencies. So let's try to get an idea of what this could mean. So first of all, I start here at the other side. So machine learning is not about memorization. So if you say to your students, learn this, very often the professor means, keep this in mind. But this is not learning, this is just memorizing. And memorizing is something that computers can do extremely well. Yeah? So if you take 10,000 pictures and you just put them into your memory and you have enough memory in your computer, then you have them in your memory, and then you can check whether you see the same picture again. This is not learning. And what you want to do in learning is called generalization. And generalization means you get a couple of instances from something, let's say tree, pictures of trees. And after that, the program has a feeling, feeling is the wrong term, it has a model for how a tree looks like in these pictures. And the computer program can apply this model to other pictures and say, well, this looks like a tree. This is generalization because it goes beyond simple examples. And it's also how we humans learn. So if I look at my little daughter, she's like this. And she, if I tell her this is something, this is this and this is that, it takes a couple of times until she has somehow grasped the concept behind this. It's not complex concepts. It's like this is a knife, don't take it. This is a fork, don't take it. This is X, don't take it. So the rules are not so complicated, but the objects are she's capable of recognizing pretty well. So let's talk about these dependencies and get an understanding what I mean when I talk about dependencies. So here I have handwritten text. It says learning. And behind is not handwritten text, and it also says learning. And we could ask a computer program to learn to recognize the letters. And what will the computer program do, or what do we want the computer program to do? We want the program to identify the written shapes and associate them with the letters that we have in mind. So this, I wrote this, it looks completely different, but this should be learned as an L, or this should be learned as an E, an A, an R, an N, an I, an N, and G. So what we actually want the computer program to learn is if you see a shape like this, this is associated with the letter blah blah, or X or Y. And this is association can be also called a dependency. So this means if there's this shape, then please associate it with the corresponding letter. So the learning part is finding the links between these two views. One view is the, somehow the input view, and the other view is the output view. So if I'm teaching machine learning, one of the problems is for in particular with students or people that already know something about learning, like on this side of the room, so I'm turning to this, they already have an idea. And likely they have one particular or multiple algorithms that they like, and they're somehow their knowledge builds around these concepts. But unfortunately, machine learning is a super diverse and super unstructured field. So it's not like quantum physics or so, where there's a a conceptual idea and then people start to work on it. But instead, the opposite is the case. So there have been many, many ideas, and they have been all somehow invented for different purposes. And in the end, people found out, oh, this is all machine learning. And this is why we have machine learning approaches from biology, neurology, physics, statistics, computer science, mathematics. It all goes together now under the umbrella of machine learning, but the origin is different. So to give you an example, when people started to work in the world of physics and were analyzing different problems where they had a lot of particles and monitored these particles, don't ask me how they did this, they were thinking about algorithms that could help them better analyze this data. And what they actually were doing is they were solving a machine learning problem, like finding dependencies between their recordings and their assumptions about what these particles would do. And therefore, some algorithms have been fully developed in the physics world. Similarly, in the 50s, people were experimenting with neurons. So they had these, there's a large, I don't know actually what it is. Is it an octopus or is it a squid? I think it's a large squid. And it has a very long neuron, which it's like almost a meter long. And in the 50s, or maybe even earlier, I'm not sure, they made experiments like putting the neuron here, making electricity there, and then measuring the signal on the other side and doing experiments. And they get a first feeling for what could a neuron be and how does it behave. And some of these people also then tried to describe this mathematically and arrived at a very simple machine learning algorithm. So there are many, many influences. Yes, I cannot name all, so just be warned if you go to the internet and maybe go to Wikipedia, which is also an interesting source of information, it might be that the people try to sell you the whole topic as something very coherent and clear, but it is not. It's a very diverse field. Okay, so to make this more security aware, I try to use a running example. And so who has experience with network intrusion detection? Some of you. Also the right side, so I think you're the honest side. So network intrusion detection is something that has been around for also 20 or 30 years. And the idea is very simple. You have network packets. I'm leaving out all the technical details, yeah, like TCP reassembly or protocol parsing. So just assume we have something like packet payloads. So we are on the application layer. And we're seeing something like this. This is a super simplified HTTP request. And network intrusion detection would actually be to have some kind of pattern. And if this pattern matches this string, then we have a detection. And we will use this setting and now see what happens if we apply machine learning to this setting. Not all of the cases that I will present to you are then intrusion detection. But they will all work on this very data, so like network packets in the simplest form. So let's start with the first important concept of machine learning and data mining. And the first, let's say, bad information is machine learning, this is here, this side, usually works in some kind of vector space. This has a little bit to do with maybe its history, but the majority of algorithms operate on vectors of real numbers. And this means if you're interested in analyzing real objects, you have some kind of gap, because real objects never live in a vector space. It's something that even by definition cannot work. So you either have this theoretical view or you have this real world view. And therefore, the first step in designing a machine learning system is constructing a feature space which describes your data in forms of vectors. I mean, there's far more to it than just vectors. But as for the introductory part, I will stick to using this kind of vector representation. And it is not so easy to describe objects in a feature space, because you can take many different information from an object and put it into a vector. But does this really count? Is this an important information? Yeah. So for example, if I would describe the people here in the room, I could measure their weight, I could take their age, I could take their sex, I could take their, I don't know, gender, if this is not the same, I could take their body temperature. But actually, what would be the goal? So if I want to find out those which are maybe smart, or those which are rich, or those who will die in a couple of years, I would need different measurements, and some of these would be totally useless. So it's a non-trivial problem to find a good representation. So in the case of intrusion detection, and maybe this also fits to some of the things you have in mind, there are, I would say, three types of strategies that you can use to create features. So one is what I already sketched a little bit, is numerical features. So you try to measure certain numerical things. How long is it? What is the byte entropy? How many alphabetic characters are in there? And I guess all of you can come up with a dozen of possible numbers that you can measure on a string. Alternatively, you could also use something like sequential features. So for example, you could look for certain strings and say they are in or they're not in. Or in the example that I did here, this is a computed using a sliding window. So instead of taking the full string, I'm moving a four-character window over the string. And then I get, no, it's like this. Then I can represent this string as a bag of snippets. Yeah, to describe it in simple terms. Or you can also, if there's some kind of delimiter symbol, you can also cut your string into pieces if you know where to cut. For example, you could cut at the white space here, and then you would get two tokens. So these sequential representations usually revolve around either generating some kind of snippets from the data, or cutting at certain positions, or if you know exactly what you're looking for, just looking for these particular things. Yeah, for example, you might look for get or index.html because you know this plays an important role in your application or system. And finally, and this is of course the academic solution, you are not messing around with these kinds of fuzzy things, but instead you say, well, this is some kind of structure. Actually, get index.html is a sentence of a formal grammar. So you can construct a parse tree around it, and then you can represent this or any HTTP request as an abstract syntax tree and things like that. This has to do with that many information we get in computers are automatically generated. And if there's some kind of generating process, there should also be a parsing process that gets you back the structural representation. My personal experience is, in many cases, this is not needed. But if you want to write an academic paper, people like it if you say, like, well, you can do it with a parse tree, and then we have an, I don't know, context tree grammar behind it, and they will say, like, very good. So for those of you who are working more in practice, I would not read. So it's a lot of work, and writing a parser for something can be super difficult. So we once wrote a parser for HTTP, not HTML, HTTP, the protocol. And it should have been super simple, right? Matter of a day or so. And it took one master student his whole master thesis to write a parser that can really parse any HTTP request. It's not that you cannot parse some requests. You can parse some for sure. But once you put it into the internet and then people come with thousands of different browsers and all these kind of headers you've never heard about, and we also saw things that are not possible or should not be possible. So writing these parsers is difficult. So if I can give you a recommendation, stick with a rather simple feature representations. So let's, now that we know a little bit about the features, try to make this a little bit formal. And I have to introduce some mathematical symbols. I try to minimize this aspect. So I dropped all the slides with the formula so far. But now I have to at least to introduce some names, variable names. And I'm doing this also because if you take a textbook on this topic, you will see the very same letters. So this helps you reading. So usually, if we talk about machine learning, we talk about X and Y. X is our input, so it's the domain, the feature space we are dealing with, and Y is our output. So this is what we want to predict. And the dependencies between these two worlds or domains are usually called theta, and this is a learning model. So the learning model describes how we get from X to Y. And therefore, we can plug our model into a function f, and then have a function that takes elements from X and returns elements of Y. Super generic, right? So there's no, so if you have some feeling of machine learning, you might say, well, I could make this more precise. This is how it should be, because machine learning is a very broad field, as I said, and you can do a lot of different things. So if you want to be generic and make it correct, then it's as generic as this. Here's an example I'm using in my lecture. It's not network intrusion detection. So these are apples and these are pears. And they are in a two-dimensional space where one dimension is the height. I think it's fantasy, but anyway. So this is, I think, the height. No, this is the color, right? And this is the height. Very good. And in this space, X would be color and height. And what we want to predict is whether this is an apple or whether this is a pear. So our learning model, if we take it super simple, could be just a straight line that separates this space into two parts. And if we get a new object, we just check, does it fall onto this side or this side? So we measure the color, we measure the height, and then we project it onto the space and see whether it falls left or right. Yes. Of course, learning methods or learning models can be more complex. So here I used a super simple straight line. Of course, you can have something which is maybe quadratic or cubic, so then you get these kind of more curvy decision surfaces. You can have really fancy lines, And of course, if you take methods from the field of decision trees and logics, you can also get things that are called decision stumps, which is a combination of edges and corners. And if you make this fine enough, it is equivalent in the infinity to this, right? So you can, if you have a lot of small edges and corners, you arrive at a very smooth decision surface. So since these learning models can look so different, there also doesn't exist one learning algorithm, but and this is the reason why there exist so many learning algorithms. So if you're working with this, you need something completely different as if you would be working with this. Still, we can describe the learning process in a generic way. So we can say learning means I'm searching in the space, big theta, of models. So maybe I take a step back here. So think of each of these models, theta, each of these lines here. So first of all, maybe I say it differently. So you can have thousands of different lines which are quadratic that separate the space. Yeah, you can have it like this, or you could have it like this, or like this, or like this. And this is the space of all possible solutions you're looking at. So this is basically everything that you can learn with the available features and the available model. And now learning means I'm walking in this space of possible solutions, and I'm trying to find the best, or at least a very good solution. And this means I'm somehow optimizing the theta in this function here, such that at the very end, I have a good classification or clustering decision. And we can have two goals for our learning setup. So the most classic learning setup is called supervised learning. In this case, I have labels. This means the learning process G knows the input, and for this input, also the output. So I know what I'm looking at. So for example, I have a couple of apples and pears. And I know these are apples, these are pears. So now I can search in the space of possible solutions and look for a solution that takes my information and does the best classification, for example. Yeah? Therefore, it is called supervised, because I know what I'm looking for. Yes. And the output of this process is a model theta, and I can plug it into my function f. The other field of machine learning, which is very often used in practice, but people sometimes really don't notice what they're doing, is called unsupervised learning. And in the case of unsupervised learning, I don't have any information about the objects I'm looking at. So I'm looking at apples and pears, but I don't know that these are apples and pears. And I want the machine learning algorithm to automatically find out whether there is something interesting in my set of objects. Of course, this is far more complex than the first example. And usually, and we will see this later, you get results, but they are often not what you expect. So if you use unsupervised learning, you somehow put your trust or your faith into an algorithm to solve a difficult problem. And if you haven't used the right features, or if you have been, I don't know, maybe a little bit lazy with thinking about what you actually do, you will get a solution, but this is not the solution you're looking at. So I can give you, yeah?
So do I understand correctly? The goal here is then to also determine the why. You don't have a why, you don't have apples and pears, but you hope as an outcome of this process that you have a why.
Yes, exactly. So for example, it's a good example. It's an example where this works is if in handwriting recognition, you can somehow give all the letters, the written digits, so from 0 to 9, to a computer program and say detect all the different digits and tell me how many digits there are. And what do you think? How many digits are there? Yeah, 10. So
naive.
Naive, no? This is the typical human thinking. You would say, yeah, of course, there are 10 different digits. But a computer program will find between 15 to 20. And the computer program is right, actually, because some people write digits differently. And these digits do not look like other digits. We know that, for example, a 1, which is just a line, and a 1, which has an angle, are the same digit. But for a computer program without knowing the why, this is why your question makes sense, there's no chance of differentiating those two. And then you get more digits than, you get as many digits as they are in a written form. But you're not getting these digits you're expecting.
It starts out with having 30,000.
Yes. Yes.
So it's already catching.
Yes, it's super cool and super useful. I just want to somehow warn you. Yes, of course. I think it's amazing because you, in this example, you give a computer program something that humans have written, and the computer program is capable of finding something out which is very close to what people had in mind when they were writing the digits. I will come to this in a couple of slides. Okay, so then, now we have this kind of learning model, and I have to jump a little bit into the theory part of this, because until now, this is something that I think everybody could come up with if he would be thinking for a longer time about learning and what I've told you so far. Like looking for a very good solution. Yeah, this is always makes sense. I mean, we learned this from our school days. Always look for the best solution, right? This will help you. And we will see here, and this is maybe also the philosophical take-home message of this lecture, not always picking the best solution can be the best solution in the long term. But to explain this, I need to introduce a little bit. So when we are looking for, let's pick as an example, a straight line as our model. So we are trying to find a good position for this straight line. And I have written +1 here if it's something is an apple, and -1 if it's a pear. So if we put the line like this, we can say, OK, 3 errors, because there are 1, 2, 3 pears on the wrong side. I can do it also like this. Then I would put the line here. And then I also have 3 errors. And then I have 1, 2, 3 apples on the wrong side. And ta-ta, if I put the line here, I have all apples here and all pears on this side, no errors. So this would be, in the perfect world, the best solution. And finding this solution, depending on the model, usually is not so difficult. Because you have some kind of optimization problem, and you look for the solution that is the best. Now, the problem is that best here is a little bit relative. So here, take this example. We have training data here. And we want to find the difference between the red and the green points. And we have two learning models. One learning model is very curvy, and one learning model is a straight line. And if we place the straight line here, we get 12% training error. Why is it 12%? I think because there's one misclassification, and I counted the dots. Yeah. If I use this curvy line, I can fit it very perfectly to my training data. So I get a very perfect solution on the data that I have. And I think one could say this is the better solution, right? Now, the goal of machine learning is not predicting something on data that you have, but predicting something on data that you don't have, that you later get. So for example, if we take this attack setting, we're interested in finding novel attacks and not the attacks that we already have captured. So we're interested in something that is called test data. And test data is by design or definition unknown. So we don't have it. And if we take these two examples here, it turns out that the model that performed very well on the training data performs worse on the test data, whereas the simple method that did not really work on the training data also does not really work on the test data, but it's better. So we are in some kind of dilemma, because if we look at our data, we should not pick the best solution. And this process of picking the wrong solution is called overfitting. So we are fitting too much on what we have, and thereby lose generalization. So this is also part of what I said in the introduction. there's a thin line between memorizing something and generalizing something. So if you want to generalize what a tree is, you maybe need to remember that a tree has green leaves and a brown root and things like that. So you need to remember something. But your generalization is in between, so you remember this roughly. But of course, there's some kind of process. You can remember more and more things and have less generalization. And you can also remember only very few things. For example, the tree is just big. And this will be too few memorization. So it's in between finding a balance between overfitting, being too specific, and underfitting, being too broad. And there's a super cool graphic from the book of Vladimir Vapnik, which is, I really love this. It looks a little bit complicated, but I can explain it to you. And this is the core of learning. And I mean, this you should keep always this plot in your mind, because I think it really helps if you're dealing with learning problems. So let's look first at the axis. So here we have one axis that I denoted as complexity of learning model. It's not a mathematical term, but think of it as something, how complex is the thing that I'm learning? Is it just a couple of numbers? Or is it a support vector machine with 10,000 support vectors? Or is it a neural network with 50 layers? Is it a decision tree with 50 million nodes? So how much complexity is in the model? Here we have super simple models. Here we have super complex models. And this axis is called the risk. Forget risk. I didn't introduce this. So think of it as error. So the bigger this gets, the more error your solution creates. So now we look at the training error. This is the amount of mistakes you make on the training data that you have. And if you increase the complexity of your learning model, the training data does continuously decrease. And if you have a good learning method, it will always reach zero training error. You can even prove this for many learning algorithms. So this means if you make it more and more complex, at some point, it will provide a perfect solution on the data that you have, which is perfect overfitting, and it's a super crap result. But you can do it. It's a little bit, so maybe I can explain. It's a little bit like a student that learns the text on all slides that you give to him or her, but does not really understand what the message is on the slides. So, and if you later give them the slides and or say, what's on slide 52? Then the student could say, yes, on slide 52, it's this and that. But this is not sufficient to generalize what's on the slide. And this is captured in the red line, which is the test error. So this is the amount of mistakes that you make on unknown data. And of course, it decreases when you start learning. But once you get too complex and too specific, it increases again. So here you have the underfitting part being too broad. And here's the overfitting part being too specific. And what we actually want to achieve in machine learning is to find a solution at this point, the best possible test error. And this is non-trivial. One idea, and this is why I said Vladimir Vapnik, is one can try to measure the complexity of the learning model. This is the blue curve here, and incorporate the complexity into the learning decision. So this means I'm looking for a good solution with a simple model. And if I'm optimizing, I try to optimize both parts. So I try to find a good solution, but at the same time, have a super simple model behind it. And if you think about maybe your daily life, maybe you also notice this in your life, that often good solutions are effective, but also simple. And if they get too complex, they have these corner cases. And this is also the same problem as with overfitting. Yeah? Or if you're developing something. So who's developing software here in the room? And who's developing software for a living? OK. So if you're developing software, at least I notice this sometimes, if some solution gets too complex, you will later spend a lot of time getting this back into some good shape. Somehow, this is also overfitting. You maybe are too specific to your concrete setting, and later have to pay the price getting back into your comfort zone. So what does it? This means that all learning algorithms, or most learning algorithms, have some kind of parameter where you can tune where they stop this process. Yeah, so an algorithm which is just put onto the data and then terminates with a solution does not exist. Instead, all of these algorithms have some kind of input parameter where you can tune something. And usually, you tune where the algorithm stops on this curve. And I think for many people, this is a disappointment. So because it's different from what we consider to be intelligent. So this means if you have a neural network, the neural network can learn, but you need to, in advance, tell the neural network, learn. Yeah, you don't know this point, and this is one of the problems. But you can say the neural network, stop rather here or stop rather there. Yeah, due to the, anyway, due to how the learning algorithm works, right? So we don't need the details here. And the same holds, for example, for a support vector machine. There's a cost function associated with it. Who knows support vector machines? Only a few. Okay. So there's a usually called C, and the C can be tuned. And by tuning the C, you usually move along this axis. Or if you're learning, who knows decision trees? And who knows what decision tree pruning is? Pruning is the process of cutting off the leaves. Like a gardener, you take your decision tree, and then you cut off certain leaves. And why are you doing this? Well, because you learned until this point your decision tree, and then you're starting to cut off the leaves to get to this point. So there are different strategies, but the goal is always the same, getting good generalization. And this means finding a balance between underfitting and overfitting. Whew. OK, so we got this message. So let's come to the next part. I need some water before. Do you have questions so far? No questions. Ah.
How far can you overfit in feature extraction? Like finding this very specific feature with this very specific, for this very specific problem.
So in principle, from a theoretical perspective, you cannot overfit on the feature world. But you can get into a feature space where you cannot find a good solution anymore. Right? There are some people, this takes too far, but there are some people that so in the 60s and 70s, people were afraid of a lot of features. So they said, like, well, we only need maybe 10 features. And this is already huge. So actually want to have 3 features. And there are still some of old professors running around telling curse of dimensionality, you should not have too many features in your data. But this is obsolete. So if you look what bioinformatics people are doing, they are throwing millions of features into these learning algorithms to find genes or other things in DNA. And you can actually not overfit in your feature design, but you could omit the important part.
So with other words, if I...
This would be stupid then.
If I try to find a feature to improve performance, that would not be a good approach, since you would just want to find a whole set of features and then learn on them.
Yeah, that's a good... Yeah, you're right. This is a very good point. I don't have it on the slides. So of course, what also can be overfitting is you have the proper setting, everything is correct, and then you look at your results, and then go back to the beginning and start to tune with the features and things like that. And optimize the whole process. Yeah? So maybe get new data. So to, in the end, have a good solution. So this covers features, but it also covers everything else, picking the learning algorithm. So in principle, if you know the outcome at the end, you can start from scratch and try to optimize everything that your solution is good. And what you need to do then in this setting is get fresh test data. This is also a mistake that I find in many papers. So if you experiment with machine learning, it's always a good idea to have an holdout data set, which you do not touch, and only use at the very end. If you touch it, it's not a holdout data set anymore, and then you need another holdout data set. But actually, I mean, it's good that you ask. I don't have. I think this is actually, if you're honest to yourself, this is the only way of doing it. Right? And the reason that we see it in some scientific papers is because they want to have quick success. I think everybody knows that if you look into the data that you're analyzing and say, like, OK, I can use this feature, and then it will be perfect, then you of course need to have some other holdout data set where you can finally measure your performance. Yeah, good that you ask. Okay, so this was the super broad generic introduction of machine learning theory. I omitted all the theory slides, but this it was in between. And I hope you get the feeling of that there was something. Now we will talk about the actual types of learning. And this is now gets more into practice. And now I can also show you my running example. So the most common form of machine learning is classification. And classification, we had it already in the slides, is a technique where you want to discriminate objects from known classes. So for example, apples and pears, or intrusions and non-intrusions and things like that. Often the y is then something like minus 1, plus 1, or 1, 2, 3. So you have a discrete space, and this discrete space are your class labels. Yeah? Think of spam, non-spam, think of important, non-important, handwriting recognition is also a classification task. You get an image, and you want to assign the image to a certain digit. Spam filtering, handwriting recognition. Here are some learning algorithms, so I'm just naming them so that you know these are used for classification problems, support vector machines, k-nearest neighbor, I will tell you what this is, and of course, neural networks. And in the simplest setting, a classification can just be a straight line in some feature space separating two sides. If we look at the intrusion detection example, then we might find some feature space where attacks and non-attacks or benign and malicious data is separated by some surface. And if new attacks come in, we would hope that they fall on the right side. And we could say, well, this is an attack. So here in my example, it's not super fantasy. It's only half fantasy. So what you see here, does somebody know this attack? Uh-huh. So this is it's simplified, but it's part of the NIMDA worm. Does somebody remember the NIMDA worm? Or am I the oldest person in the room? Very good. So NIMDA worm 2005 was exploiting a vulnerability in Internet Information Server, so this Microsoft web server. And the vulnerability built on a double encoded character in the URI. Yeah, so I'm not talking about this, it takes too long, but double encoding can be a problem. So you can see here %%, and this means if first this part is translated and there's a character coming out, and then this part is translated, we get a backslash, and then the web server would not block this request, and then in fact this application would be executed. 2005, it's 10 years ago. The problem with this attack was that you could not only use this double encoding, but also this double encoding and also this double encoding. So in fact, if we would learn something like how this attack looks, for example, this part and this part, we could maybe generalize a classifier such that also the other attacks are on the right side. Potentially. Yeah, I didn't do it, but so just to give you a feeling, this is not full fantasy here, but it has some real part in the real world. So then, somehow the brother of classification or sister is clustering, and very often security people confuse this, and it drives me mad. So clustering is a technique where I want to group something into classes, but I do not know the classes in advance. So this is what you asked in the beginning. I do not have the class labels, and I even don't know how many classes exist. I can maybe guess or so, but in the worst case setting, I have no idea of what I'm looking at. So the output domain is again a discrete set, like 1, 2, 3, 4, but I don't know what these numbers represent. So here in this example, I did some kind of pseudo clustering. And the idea is here that the cluster does not discover what are apples, what are pears, but instead it discovers objects more on terms of the color. Yeah? So I've chosen this example to illustrate you get a result, but maybe it's not the result you're looking for. So here we get all the red fruits, the yellow fruits, and the green fruits. This technique has been used a lot in malware analysis because if you have different attacks or you have a different malicious programs, and you maybe run them in a sandbox, you can observe what they're doing, and then you can run clustering to find out, is this the same malware family or is it a different malware families, and how many malware families exist? Yeah. Usually, in this case, you have some kind of mathematical formulation. So you're looking for a solution, so like this clustering. This is one example, where the distances in a cluster are small and the distances between clusters are big. So it's a mathematical, I mean, it doesn't have a direct interpretation. But then these algorithms will try different combinations of clusterings and find the solution where something like this holds. This doesn't, by the way, hold for my example here, because the clusters are very close to each other. And you might also put those into one cluster or those into one cluster. But sometimes you have the data somehow distributed in the space at very different places, and then it's straightforward to find the clusters. But good question. Typical algorithms, k-means clustering and linkage clustering, they have been around for also 60 years or so. So they're quite old algorithms. And if you look in a textbook, you will likely find them. So here in the case of network intrusion detection, it might look like this. You have maybe different types of attacks. So maybe this is attack type Z. And if we now do a clustering in the space of everything that we captured, for example, with a honeypot or something like this, we might also find other attack types which are different in the structure, and the clustering would help us to get a large pool of data into a couple of groups and then inspect these groups individually. So this, does somebody know this vulnerability? So you're not the hardcore black hat guys here? So this was a very, very stupid thing in PHP. Basically, after this comment, you could add further shell comments and things like that, or PHP code. I wasn't not sure, but this is was really, really dangerous. Also, likely 8 years ago. So this would be clustering. So then we have another unsupervised technique, which is also related to detecting something like attacks or threats. And this is called anomaly detection. And the idea here is I'm not learning the difference between what is good and what is bad, but I try to learn only one class of my data. So I try to find out what is normal. And in principle, my output domain could then be described as some kind of continuous number between 0 and 1, expressing the anomaly of my objects that I'm looking at. So my slides, there's a circle missing. So in principle, here in this example, we could use something like a circle and try to fit it around the data. And if we use a good optimization problem, let's say something like a one-class support vector machine, it will move into the middle of this plot. And the two outer objects, the apple and the pear here, would be anomalies because they deviate from this normality. And also, your question also is somehow implicitly shown here. So we assume that the data somehow forms some kind of shape or manifold or cloud in the space, and that we can describe it, and everything that deviates from this can be detected. This has been used in intrusion detection for many years, but it's also used in Formula One. I think this is more important. So if you have a Formula One car or Formula E, doesn't matter, can also be electric, you measure different things from your engine, and then you can try to derive a model, what is the normal operation of the engine, so like temperature, fuel flow, oil pressure, and things like that. And they're doing it, so I'm not making this up. So they measure something like this, and then when they do these races, they monitor if there are anomalies in these combinations of the features. So it doesn't need, it's not necessarily that the temperature of the engine is super high or the pressure is low, but maybe it's a very unusual combination of those features. And this might indicate a failure with the engine. And then they go back into the, what is it called? Box stop? Pit stop, exactly. And then they change the car or whatever. I have no idea. But in principle, anomaly detection is a very useful tool to spot anomalies, unusual activities. And it's not as simple as just looking at one value, but very often it's a combination of values. Therefore, you cannot do it by hand. In the case of machine learning and the case of intrusion detection, it could be that we build a model on the normal data, so let's say normal web traffic of our web server, and we could hope that attacks would fall outside of this circle. And then we have two further types of learning methods. Those are not very often used in the context of security, but I'm just giving the you for completeness. So one is regression. It's a supervised technique, so it's very related to classification. But the goal is not to predict classes, but to predict a continuous value. Yeah? So the output domain is something like R, the real numbers. And you need this, for example, if you want to forecast the temperature. So if you want to know how cold is it in Leuven, or it wasn't that cold, but rainy or something like this, you do not want to have a class like rainy, not rainy, but you rather would have to have something like probability of rain is 80%, 70%, 60%. So you need a continuous measure. Or what I tell my students, if you want to get rich, you can somehow predict changes in the stock market. And here also, you do not want to just say yes or no, but instead you want to say they are at a certain value. And then usually you use, here I had, I'm trying to predict the sweetness of these fruits. And my thesis is if they are red, they are more sweet, which I'm not really sure if this holds. But the reds, if I remember right, the reds start with green, right? So in principle, yeah, could be the case. So here you're predicting some kind of continuous value. There are, however, at least to my knowledge, no or very few applications in the world of security. I know that some people try to predict the likeliness of vulnerabilities in software using something like this. But in the very end, it was a little bit, I don't know, hard to grasp. And also, I've never seen something similar again. So maybe it wasn't that great. And another technique, this can be used in security, but it's also rather generic, is called dimension reduction. It supports supervised and unsupervised approaches. And the idea basically here is I have an input space Rn, and I have an output space Rm. And the relation between n and m is that n is much bigger than m. So in other terms, I have generated all these huge features. I've thought about different measurements. So let's think of this engine. So you measure all possible things in this engine. And in the end, you want to break it down into two numbers or three numbers. What you then need is dimension reduction. So it's a technique that will try to find a good model that maps high-dimensional data to low-dimensional data. We've been using this extensively in vulnerability discovery. And surprisingly, it worked very well. So the idea is here exactly what I said. Instead, we are not looking at an engine, but at software. And our idea was to take a lot of measurements from the software, in particular from the parse tree of the software. So we had a parser. It was C++. We extracted subtrees. And we had a very huge feature space. And then condensed the feature space into 50 or, I think, in some case, even 10 dimensions. And what did this do? It did basically denoise the software in some extent. I'm not sure if you can imagine what this is. But so software is full of thousands of small elements, small that the programmer adds to, like, statements, if statements, variable names, types, how loops are structured, how functions are organized, all these things. And somehow, for the bigger context, this can be considered noise. And the bigger context is maybe there's a big loop processing input data, or there's a loop that goes over a buffer, or there's an if statement, and then a loop goes over a buffer. And now we turn to simple patterns, which are related to security. So for example, if there's always an if statement, and then something is copied into a buffer, and there's a case where something is copied into a similar buffer, but there's no if statement, could this be a missing check? But to get to this higher level, vulnerability dimension reduction is a super important technique because it helps us to get rid of this stuff. Actually, I have at another summer school, I was talking about this topic for 3 hours. So in case you now got interested, I cannot cover it here. But I think it's interesting because it's an unusual application of machine learning in a scenario where you usually don't use fuzzy methods.
Yeah.
Okay, so we have 20 minutes left. And I think you now have somehow learned a lot, but my feeling is it's not super useful, right? So the problem is I had to cover all this now to come to the point where we can talk normally about machine learning. So there's only 20 minutes left. So what can I do? So my idea is I present to you like in 2 minutes or 3 minutes algorithms that are used in practice. Yeah, and maybe this knowledge can be used in your later work. So so somehow we opened the gates, but now it's too late. But also, I hope that this kind of introduction helps you to also do your own self-study. Yeah? I know nobody likes self-study, but in principle, you learn more if you look at something and apply it yourself, right? So this is what I tell my students, and it's true. I must admit, I did not learn much when I was in university. I just learned this when I did it then in the homeworks. And I also did it when I had to do the homeworks, right? So this is the reason now that I'm presenting to you, I think, how many do I have? Four learning algorithms. So let's maybe summarize everything so that you get an idea where we are now. So I started with the very basics of machine learning. These functional dependencies, overfitting, underfitting, learning model. Okay. Then I talked about to you how different types of learning we can have. So like classification, clustering, animal detection, regression. And now we are at the very bottom of the whole field. Now we are at the concrete algorithms, those algorithms that implement everything that I talked about before. Right? So if this is a big tree, I started from the root, moved down, and now I can only show you some of the leaves. Yeah? But most of the leaves I cannot cover simply because it's an exponential growth. Okay, so I start with the simplest and surprisingly one of the most successful learning algorithms. It's called k-nearest neighbors. And if you want to implement machine learning yourself, you do not want to have a library, you have a simple problem, a problem which doesn't require huge amounts of data, this is your first choice. And it's implemented in 10 minutes, I would say. And everybody here in the room can, I would say, implement this in 10 minutes. It's not, So this is I'm showing it. Now it gets practical. Okay, so why is it so simple? So the idea is the following. The training phase, or learning, is nothing. Learning means here, save the data. And I think you all can do this, right? So we already solved the learning phase. The only thing that is missing is the prediction phase. So this is where we get a new data point and want to predict the class label of the new data point. And the algorithm is simple. If you have a new point, you just take some kind of distance measure and measure the distance to the other points and look for the k nearest points to this one and then take the class label or whatever y you have from these surrounding points and do a majority voting. And that's the algorithm. Yeah, so in principle, if you come home, you can directly apply this. So if you have, 10,000 log lines, then you define some kind of distance measure between the log lines. So this could be maybe you design some features, length, this and that word is contained. You can also use something like the edit distance, or if you, you're free to define some distance measure. You put your data in, and if some new point comes, you just check for the k nearest neighbors in your representation. So actually, you should now have two questions to me. So the first question is, where is the regularization? So where is this generalization? Where is the learning? Is it lost? It's implicitly encoded in the size of your neighborhood. Because if in this example here, if you look k is 4, you would predict this point to be red. Whereas if you would pick k equals 11, you would say the point in the middle is green. So this generalization here is encoded of how many neighboring points do I look at to make a decision. And the more points you look at, the more blurry or the more smooth, yes, the more smooth gets your decision function. Because you take in a lot of things you have seen and then take the majority. Whereas if you have a small k, you only look at the surrounding, and then your prediction can change. If you just move a little bit to the left or the right, your prediction can flip because your majority switches. And what is the second question that you should ask?
How good is it? How well can this deal with a little bit noisy data?
It can deal with noisy data. This is exactly, if you would, you would increase the k if you have more noise. But what about runtime? So the downside of this algorithm is runtime. In the implementation that I have sketched, or the algorithm, you would basically need to compare an incoming point to all the points in your training set. So if this is 10 million, you would need 10 million computations. There are some clever tricks. So who knows ball trees? KD trees? OK. Anyway, then if you don't know it, then you need to stick with the slower. There are some tricks to make this faster, but the problem remains. Measuring the distance to a set is always an expensive operation. So here's another learning algorithm, which has become, so when I studied, one of my professors was, I wouldn't say a pioneer, but one of these big shots in neural networks. And he wrote a book about neural networks. And we were in the lecture, and we said, well, this is old guy stuff. Who's using neural networks? At that time, there were new algorithms coming up. They were more efficient. They were better. They were faster. Now, computers have become much faster. And we also have GPUs now, which can do a lot of things in parallels. And therefore, there is a rebirth of this neural network technology. And now everybody is talking about deep learning. Take an arbitrary scientific paper about, I don't know, are you interested in security of X? Add deep learning in front, and now it's super sexy. Or if you have self-driving cars, you would always say it's deep learning that's inside the self-driving cars. Unfortunately, it's not in many cases, but who cares? It's more sexier if it's... So what is a neural network? So actually, a neural network, we have it in our brains. But when I, in my studies, so in Germany or at my university, you had to do one subject outside of your main research field. So I was a computer scientist, and obviously I had to take some other subject. And I picked biology for fun. And also because the ratio of female to male students was far better in biology. Yeah. What I learned there is that the neural networks in the brain is completely different from anything that we use in computers. Even though this is called a neural network, it's super far away. And one reason, for example, is that in a brain, you also have these kind of, you have physical processes. So for example, if I drink a beer, there's some kind of substance coming into the network, and it influences all neurons in the network. So it has a global effect. Similarly, in the brain, you can have regions where you have only a couple of neurotransmitters being active, and they have a local region where they influence neurons. This is not modeled in this kind of algorithm here. Instead, the neural networks in computers are just simple graph-based networks where you have some kind of input layer. Then you have nodes where the information is propagated to. And finally, you have an output layer where the information arrives. And in each of these nodes, you usually perform a simple mathematical operation, like, for example, adding all the values together and applying some function on the output. This is what currently is considered a neural network. And learning means I'm putting data into this input layer and observe the output. And if the output is wrong, I try to go backward, this is then called backpropagation, and try to adapt these edges such that the output becomes better. And I do this in a couple of times, and this is why this takes a lot of computation power. So you go back and forth during learning and try to adapt the weights and the edges such that when you input something, you get the right output. And yeah, and the deep learning algorithms are very similar to this. The only difference is you do not have one layer in between, but maybe 10 layers. And this is why it's called deep learning. So the question is, where does the generalization happen? It's a little bit unclear. One problem of neural networks is that if you have a lot of these edges, your models are very complex. And therefore, they can learn a lot of information. And therefore, they tend to overfit. Yeah, because they can memorize parts of your image or parts of your input. And there are two strategies that can be used to make the model more generic. This is called regularization. Sorry, I didn't have the term. And my favorite one is brain damage. Brain damage is like a little bit like drinking alcohol, so you destroy some of the edges in your network. You can do this randomly, for example. So this helps. It helps you learning better because you're not overfitting and you will need to use your remaining neurons to build a better model. Or another strategy, I think this is better, is called weight decay. This means if these edges have a very low weight, you drop them. And therefore, you strengthen the other edges. This is a little bit like, in my understanding, also humans learn. So if you learn to play piano or you learn to ride a bicycle, somehow those connections in your brain that are responsible are strengthened by the repetition of the task. Yeah? And other things that might be interesting when riding a bicycle, like how the air smells or so, is reduced to somehow focus you on this task. This is a little bit the maybe inspiration for weight decay. And then the favorite of all computer scientists, the decision tree. People think it's super simple, but it's far from being simple. And so theoretically, a decision tree is something like this. At each node, you make a decision on a particular feature. So you would say here, feature XA is smaller or bigger than 3. And then you would pass through the tree. And at the end, you end at leaves. And the leaves are associated with labels. So if you end on these two leaves, you get class 1. If you end here, you get class minus 1. So why do computer scientists love this? Because they have the feeling this is something manageable and you can understand it, and it's good. So I remember a couple of years ago when my colleagues from the security field came to me and said, now we don't like what you're doing. We need to do this with decision trees. And then we have a good, understandable, clear model. It's a tree, and we can look at it. What they didn't know is that these trees can grow. And they can grow very, very large. So if you look into a textbook, you get this. And of course, this can be explained. But we did this, for example, for network intrusion detection. And we ended up with a tree with 10,000 nodes. And I don't know, several thousands of leaves. And of course, we could not look at the tree. We tried, but it was not possible. And in fact, there was no difference between a neural network and a decision tree in terms of understandability. They were both not understandable. And this feeling that you have as a computer scientist that trees are good and that you can understand them, this only holds for small trees, and it doesn't hold for large trees. And in the end, in my view, it doesn't really matter what kind of technique you use. Here's another example. What currently is used, people are not using decision trees alone today. The most common method are random forests. And a random forest is just a forest of trees. The trees are not constructed exactly the same. So you add a little bit of protection against overfitting to this forest. So because each of your trees can slightly overfit. But if you take all of the trees and then make majority voting, you're safe again. Right? It's a little bit the same motivation as for k-nearest neighbor. So, and then We come to the last algorithm. So this is a support vector machine, also super popular, used for classification. It was in the 90s a super hyped algorithm, and I'm also one of this generation. Not from my age, but somehow due to my advisors, I got a little bit hooked. So support vector machines have a, I think, very intuitive concept. So the idea is your learning model is very simple. It is a straight line, or it's a hyperplane. So all of the examples that I showed you previously are actually support vector machines. The only difference is before you look for this straight line, you apply some kind of map function called a kernel function that maps your original feature space into some super fancy, super cool, super theoretic space, which has amazing properties and where mathematicians can write their PhD thesis on. Yeah? So it's really complex. It has a lot of funny properties, and often it's infinite dimensional, so it has infinite dimensions, so you can put as many data in it as you want to. It can take anything. It's highly nonlinear very often, so you have a lot of bumpy surfaces and things like that. However, in this super complex space, you just learn a simple function. And this means that the algorithm actually is not so complicated. And it's a little bit the math behind it, or the mathematics. But from a computer science perspective, I really like it, because you have some mathematical concepts or a mathematical function. You apply the function to your data, and then you learn something that is actually not so complicated. And the prediction works then as follows. If you have a new point, you map it also into this space, and then you check on which side of the hyperplane the point falls. There's something that I missed, but I have it here. The second idea of the support vector machine is not to pick one hyperplane that separates the two classes, but to pick the particular hyperplane that has the maximum margin. And this is also something which is very intuitive. So if you want to separate two places, like here and this, and you want to make a good general decision, you would pick the decision boundary here, right? Because then chances are that you make less errors here and less errors there. If I were to separate the two places and put my decision here, then likely I will make mistakes in this region because I'm too close to one of the classes. It's super intuitive. So I can recommend this a lot. So there are many, many other learning algorithms. There's also many other theory on this. And I haven't talked about probabilities and probability distributions, all those things that you really like as an engineer. So there's a lot of math behind this and a lot of theory. I can recommend the top book. It's really, really good. But it's super expensive. I think it costs 200 euro or maybe 250 euro. But the authors have a preprint on their homepage. I think there's some kind of dubious explanation why, but they have the book online. So if you look for Duda, Hart, and Stork, you will find this exact book in the internet. Then there's a book that I really liked from Shaw Taylor and Christianini. It covers the support vector world, but also a lot of simple learning algorithms that build on geometry, so like finding circles, or it's not a circle, it's a sphere in a multidimensional space, finding spheres, finding cubes, and things like that. I don't know if there's a pirated version of this book. It's not pirated, it's a preprint, so it's not identical to the book, right? Yeah, and then there are many algorithms that I didn't cover, which are also interesting. Boosting, begging, genetic algorithms, reinforcement learning, things like that. So maybe if you look now after this talk into the media, you will find these terms. And some did I cover, others I did not cover. OK, so brings me to the summary. And yeah, it's since I condensed like 24 hours into one lecture, the summary falls a little bit short. So because the first part here is more about security, which was just two slides of the talk. So of course, I'm just rephrasing here the motivation. I say we need to think about machine learning, and you maybe need to think about machine learning because the attackers are using more and more automatized techniques. And if you want to somehow defend, you need to think about making your defenses more efficient. And you can do this with manpower, you can do this with brain power, or you can do it with machine learning. Yeah? So if you're smart enough to come up with a super, with a very good solution, you don't need machine learning. If you have a team of security experts at your hand, you can throw the team at the problems. But likely, you don't have the time and maybe also don't have the money to throw big teams on problems. And then some of these learning methods can help. And the reason I showed you the different types, instead of going into one particular example, is that I wanted to make you capable of picking the right learning type for your problem. Right? So if you want to do anomaly detection, you should know what anomaly detection is. If you want to do classification, you should know what this is. Or if you want to do clustering, you should know what this is. And I hope that you learned what this is and that these things are not the same, just different names. No, these things are completely different. And the algorithms are completely different, and the strategies also. Yes, and the second part of this slide also covers stuff that was not in the lecture. So this is how we are using this. So maybe just, again, the motivation. So we are, in fact, using this to detect and analyze threats. And we also do it to find vulnerabilities. So we even have this prevention part where we're not waiting for somebody attacking us, but instead try to be proactive. OK, so if you have questions. That's a very good question, and I don't have an answer for you. So this has to do with the history of machine learning and all these different algorithms somehow solving the same problem. So in many cases, you can pick any algorithm that implements the learning type you want to use. It's even the case if you're in academia and you write a paper that the reviewers will say, why did you use this algorithm? Use this one. And then you will add a small table to your paper, and then you would say, we used support vector machines, we used random forests, and we used neural networks, and guess what? The result is always the same. But it's a little bit philosophical, not philosophical. Here in this room, it's not philosophical, but in the machine learning world, they are like clear preferences. It's a little bit like religion or so. If you come from the neural network world, you would always say, the rest is crap. Yeah, because it doesn't have a strong motivation. So neural networks, they are inspired from biology, and that's why they should be preferred and researched. And then there's the support vector people who say, like, we have a strong theory and strong mathematical background, so we pick the learning algorithms with the strongest theory. And then there comes the random forest and decision tree people who say, like, trees are super easy to implement. And this is also true. We have very efficient tree representations. We can also make this easily in parallel. And so, for example, random forests is one of the easiest algorithms to parallelize, because you have 10 or 200 decision trees, so you learn them in 200 processes. So simple. So no answer. Yeah. Yeah, so it's not missing from machine learning, it's missing from my slides. yes, of course, there are strategies. This is then called online learning. So this means every input point is somehow integrated into the model. I'm leaving this out because online learning is super, I say super too often, it's very dangerous in terms of security, because this means that anything you somehow judge also influences future decisions. And a colleague of mine did a lot of research on this. And it's extremely difficult, if not impossible, to defend an online learning system against an adversary. So just imagine the following. So think of an enemy detection world where you have some kind of sphere, and points that fall outside are attacks. And points that fall inside are used to build this sphere. So what my colleague did, he started to move points to the border inside the sphere. Those are normal, but then the sphere started to move, and then it started to grow. So first it moved because there was less points here, and then it needed to grow because the normal points that were okay when they came in influenced the size. And he could show that if you do this with an efficient strategy, you would manage to get all your attack points into the normal bubble. So online learning is, and the next thing, so also, I'm skeptical about online learning. Humans do it, we are super smart. Think about a car. So if you drive with your car, so for example, when I came here yesterday to Leuven, it was very gray. And when I started in Braunschweig, it was actually pretty nice weather. So if I would now do online learning here, I would came back to Braunschweig with a very gray intuition of street signs and things like that. So this could be dangerous. Fortunately, Braunschweig will also be gray.
In the car example, you have to learn how to drive a car, and driving a car now is like not really different than driving a car like 10 years ago. So, well, security now and security in 10 years or from 10 years ago is really different.
Yes. So, I mean, from a research perspective, these online approaches are interesting because they would somehow enable you to get rid of a defined training and application phase. And we also did this in the past. But we also got a lot of negative feedback from the community on this. So security people favor solutions that at some point are somehow fixed, this is what you now have, and then apply it. Instead of have something that is so dependent on the input that you can never really decide what the current state is. Yes, in theory. So first of all, you can continuously go from offline learning to online learning. In the extreme case, you learn on each new sample. So this is the extreme. What you said is you learn every day, so you have a couple of instances. The problem is where do you get your ground truths? If you have a method that generates your ground truths, so it says this is an attack, this is not an attack, this is already would be a good detector. So usually ground truth, generation of ground truth is a slow process. And therefore you're doing exactly what you said. You take your own predictions for improving the model. And this is dangerous. Also for humans, by the way. Yeah, so if you're very confident of yourself and you never really listen to feedback from others, it might be that you have the wrong impression of your own stuff. Okay, so then I think we are ready for the coffee break, right? Okay. So it's good to see you all back. Nobody left. This can only have two meanings. So either this first session was good, or there is no alternative, and outside it's cold. So. Okay, so I like to make the things that I talked about more concrete. So, however, now looking at my time schedule, I think we, at maybe 20 minutes or so, we make a small voting here and then decide which route we pick to save some time, so that in the end you can ask some more questions. So, my feeling is that there are some kind of questions boiling in your head, and they need to come out. So, but I start with a more concrete context now. So instead of talking about apples and pears, we will talk about threat detection. So I say threat detection to avoid the term intrusion detection, because everybody has an idea of what intrusion detection is, this is something boring. So I talk about threat detection, and then it can also be detecting an APT in your network and things like that. So we want to spot attacks, and we want to use machine learning for this. And I like to somehow explain in this session more concrete and with more examples how we would do this, and maybe this is also interesting for you. First of all, this looks like a perfect setting for machine learning, because usually you say, yes, if I want to define an attack, then there seems to be something that is an attack, and there seems to be something which is not an attack. And this means I have two classes, and this is a classic classification problem, and I could just throw a classifier at it and get it. However, detecting attacks or threats is not an average machine learning task, and this is why I'm here and you're not in some kind of regular machine learning course. So first of all, we have a problem with effectivity. If you build a detection system for attacks or for spam, you have two errors. You can either miss an attack, or you can mark something normal as malicious. And unfortunately, in the security context, these errors do not have the same weight. In fact, what we do not want to have are false alarms. Everybody hates false alarms. And my former supervisor invented the term, the administrator dilemma also. We never published anything about this, but the idea is if you have so many false alarms that the administrator spends the whole day looking at false alarms, at some point he will shut off the system. And therefore, it's not always a matter of how many attacks do I spot, but very often, how many false alarms do I not make? And this makes my system usable. So that's the first problem. This is different from regular machine learning. So to give you an example, if I go to amazon.com or .de and you go to .be, you get these recommendations. You don't go there, OK. But anyway, it doesn't matter. If you get these recommendations. And in many cases, the recommendations are wrong for me. Yeah, so when I once bought a DVD, Desperate Housewives, for my wife, and I still get these recommendations. There's a new season. And this is a false alarm in this context. But Amazon doesn't care. They know that I will still use Amazon in the next 10 years because they have other advantages. And these false alarms do not hurt them. In the case of security, it hurts. And for example, in the case of spam filtering, if some of your important mails are dropped from your inbox and disappear, this is a serious problem. So this is one of the problems that we have to face. Another one is efficiency. In the network setting, very often we have thousands, millions of packets. Also in the web world, if you have a web service, you likely have thousands of requests per minute. And making decisions gets difficult. And having a large neural network might not be tractable in this setting. And finally, I unfortunately cannot talk a lot about of this because it's also a topic in its own. Learning can also be a victim of attacks. We had this in the online learning setting, but also in the offline learning setting. We are taking something from an untrusted party, and we say this is the data. Yeah? So for example, we record our network traffic. And we say our network traffic is OK. And then we learn something on it. But the truth is, do we really know that this network traffic is trustworthy? And could it be that an attacker is preparing an attack by tampering the data such that when we record it, it's already manipulated? This seems now very unlikely. But it is unlikely because nobody is using, or very few people are using, machine learning in a security context. But if in a couple of years everybody is using machine learning in a security context, it will be a standard state-of-the-art attack to look for weaknesses in the learning method instead of the rest. There's a couple of papers that came out in the last year and this year that deal exactly with this topic. So to give you an example, In one of these papers, they have a very, very, I think, illuminating example. So they have a stop sign, and they have a neural network that is trained to recognize street signs. And this neural network is used in cars such that the car knows, aha, this is a stop sign, this is some other sign. And they manipulate a few pixels of this stop sign image. And it's visually, you cannot see this manipulation. It still looks like a stop sign. But the algorithm does not recognize it anymore. What's interesting now is in the paper, they argue that this is some kind of problem of neural networks. They were not in this lecture. We know likely this is overfitting. So likely the learning algorithm has picked certain features in the sign, certain pixels, and learned if pixel number 12 is red, this is a stop sign. Now if you remove pixel number 12 and make it black, then it's not a stop sign. So to me, this smells like an overfitting problem. But nonetheless, we will have also overfitting in practical systems. Why not? I mean, it's a difficult problem. And this means in applying machine learning into practice, we also need to think about attacks against the learning. I talked about what is called poisoning initially, so like tampering with the training data. And the stop sign example is a case of evasion, where I try to get around the correct decision. OK, so let's look a little bit more into detail and try to understand how we could find attacks in data. So what we are not looking at is the classical approach that is implemented by most virus scanners and intrusion detection systems. This is modeling the malicious site. Note that a virus scanner has signatures that mainly capture characteristics of the malicious party. Yeah, so each of these signatures in your scanner describes a certain computer virus, or worm, or malicious program. It does not account for the good side. Since we are now applying algorithm and can start from scratch, we can try different things. So we could look for the benign side. So we could try to model what is normal. Or we could try to look for the difference between malicious and benign, which would be classification. And this would be anomaly detection. And maybe here, to save time, I think it makes sense to only cover one of the two. So you can decide which of the two you want to learn about. So who, or maybe should I decide? I know better, right? So the slides are all excellent, of course. But I think, so, and I did my PhD thesis on anomaly detection. But to be honest, I think this helps you more in practice because it's a more versatile tool. And it can also differentiate any classes, basically, right? This could also be whatever you want, good wine and bad wine, or it doesn't matter. Where this case requires a setting where you have something like normality. And for example, in the Amazon example, the recommendation system, there is no normality. Amazon wants just to predict which objects I want to buy. So they have a classification setting. And anomaly detection doesn't make any sense in this case. And also in many other settings, anomaly detection is not the right tool. I had the Formula One example. So there are some cases where it makes sense. So we will go for the classification case. OK, but yeah, and then we can save, I think, about 8 or 9 slides. And this gives us another 15 minutes at the end so that we are also not late for lunch. So I'm starting again with this network payload that we have been seeing already in the first session. And now we look at these features in a little bit more detail to see how they look like. And I hope that at the end, you also are capable of implementing something like this yourself. It's a hope, but I try to make it more detailed. So to understand this, we start with a numerical feature. So how can I get numerical features that describe something that I have? And I basically described this already in an abstract notion. Now we make it a little bit more concrete. So we have something that we get in, which is our x. Think of this x as a string. And then you measure all sorts of things and put them into a vector. And we will call this vector now phi. And these entries phi 1 to phi n. And that's our representation. So for example, if we have this HTTP request, now it's a little bit more detailed. We could define 4 numerical features which would be the length, the byte entropy. Do you all know what the byte entropy is, or Shannon entropy? So it's a measure of information content to some extent. And it indicates, in principle, the perturbation. I don't know actually how the formal definition is. Anyway, it's a measure of information. And then you could count something like the number of printable characters or the number of non-printable characters. And I think if you have some data that you are interested in your application or in your work, or also in your research, you could just do the same with this data and define numerical measures. Something is important here. Usually I have a couple of slides on this, but I'm omitting them here. If you take these measurements, very often they are not on the same scale. So some numbers can be very large, and other numbers are very, very small. So for example here, the length of an HTTP request is at least in one hundredths and more. Whereas the number of non-printable characters in an HTTP request is rather small, let's say 10 or even less. And this means if you want to throw these different numbers into the same learning algorithms, you need to put them onto the same scale. And this is then called normalization. If you don't do this, it might be that one feature is so big that just from the pure mathematical part, it will dominate all the computations. And it might be that the rest just vanishes in the floating point part of your numbers. Yeah? So if you add a very big number to a very small number in floating point arithmetics, it might be that you lose all the information from the small number. Yeah, this is just a it's a problem that is cannot be directly solved. Instead, you should bring the different numbers onto the same scale. There are different techniques to do this. I'm not covering them. You can just look them up. One simple strategy, I recommend it because it's so simple, is just normalize the data between 1 and 0. Yeah? So find out what is the maximum of your training data, find out what is the minimum of your training data, and then normalize it to 1 and 0. It's not perfect. You can do far better and smarter things, but this is the first start. Another option is you compute the mean of your feature and subtract the mean so that you move that the mean is 0. So then your features go from plus to minus, and on average are in the middle, and you deviate your feature by the standard deviation. This is also to move it to some fixed space. But anyway, if you're doing this and you already see that the numbers are very different, then you need to normalize. So let's talk about the sequential features. So what could you do there? So I already sketched this, but I didn't really make it more concrete and more formal. I like formal stuff, unfortunately. So you can describe the sequential representation as follows. You have an object X, and you want to characterize it by words from some language L. Yeah, this language can be fixed, like, for example, you define certain words you're interested in. So for example, you have a log file, and you say the word authentication failed is something that you're interested in. Then this would be a word in your language. Or you could say, I'm interested in all occurrences of the word authenticated, whether failed or not, doesn't matter. Failed is another word. So then you would have two words in your language, authentication and failed, and maybe also successful or succeeded. So then you would have three words. So you could define explicitly a dictionary of things you're interested in. Or as in the example I will show you in the next slide, you can also implicitly define this by generating snippets from your string, just cutting it into pieces with some rule. Then you would get this language L. And now the feature mapping basically maps an instance from the things you're interested in, let's say a string, into an L-dimensional space. It's a little bit weird notation, where each dimension corresponds to the occurrences of the particular word. So let's make this more concrete. If W in this example is the word Löwen, and the word Löwen appears two times in my string, there would be one dimension in my vector where there's a 2 for these two occurrences. And if I have 10 words, I would have 10 dimensions. And if I have 10,000 words, I would have 10,000 dimensions. Okay? Are you still with me? This is a very effective way of modeling string data, and it can be applied to all sorts of representations. Yes. Yeah.
You can do it on another scale as well, on charity level, for example.
Yes. Yes. So in principle, what's behind this is called in literature vector space model, or sometimes back of words model. So back of somethings model. So you have a back of something that describes your data, and then you put each of these objects onto a dimension and count how often it occurs. Yeah. So for example, I could say my back consists of questions. Let's say stupid questions, good questions, long questions, short questions for this session. And then I would have four dimensions, and I could describe the sessions in terms of these occurrences of these objects. Right? This was your question. You said characters. But this, of course, you can do characters, words. You could also use sentences. So you can put basically anything in this representation that has a sequential structure. So let's make this example more concrete
here.
So if I take this HTTP request again, and this time I'm looking at snippets of two characters. So I'm cutting the request into pieces, and I look at all possible substrings which have only two characters. Then I would have EC two times in my vector.
Why?
Because it's here and there. XZ never, hopefully, and x86 once. And what's important to note here, and this is what we also discussed in the coffee break, this vector can be very, very large. It can have thousands of dimensions. So I'm actually throwing everything in that I can get. However, in most of the dimensions, I will have zeros for a given object. Because in a string of a certain length, there can only be a limited number of substrings. And those dimensions will be non-zero. But all the other substrings, which are not part, will be zero. The same holds. So people do the same approach to analyze natural language. And they have a dictionary of all the words that are in Dutch or in French or in German or English. And if you have this dictionary, if you take a particular sentence, the sentence will contain only a very, very limited number of these words, maybe 10 or so. So you have a large vector with very few non-zero dimensions. And many machine learning algorithms work very, very well with this setting. I know that there are people afraid of this, but there's no reason to be afraid. The reason why people are afraid is that if you explicitly store the vector with all these thousands of zeros, it is very, very large. But I think we're in the room here smart enough to know if we have a very sparse representation, we only store the non-zero elements, and the rest is stored implicitly. And there are implementations that can do this. But if you go into practice and pick a particular implementation for learning, then just check whether it supports sparse input data. So then in the third case, we can have this more principled and academic approach where we do not simply cut something, but instead we understand what it really is, and then have something like substructures, like a tree or graph, and then extract these substructures and do a very similar approach. However, and this is maybe important for you, I should have had an own slide on this and instead dropped this one here. More practical and far easier to implement is feature hashing. So this means you have some kind of interesting structures, trees or graphs or images or things. Instead of representing them explicitly and saving them and things like that, you just hash them. And then you get a back of hash values. And the back of hash values is actually exactly this. In this case, your language are just all possible hash values. This is a trick that was introduced about 2009. So it took the machine learning people a long time to discover hash functions. And the main reason was that hash functions are the worst enemy of machine learning. So the goal of a hash function is that it's one way and it destroys everything that is behind what is put into. So it's actually something that is very destructive. In this setting, however, you can exploit this fact. So you can take an arbitrary complex object, hash it to a certain hash value, and you can be sure that if you take another object, the chances of a collision are not so high due to the properties of the hash function. Yeah? Hash functions should have very few collisions, depending on the size. So this means you get a huge feature space again. Each dimension is associated with a hash value, but only few of these are non-zero. So instead of reading this slide, I recommend if you have something that has a structure, don't mess too much with analyzing and representing the structure. Instead, write a hash function that can capture the structure and then work with the hashes. The only downside is you risk collisions. But we are not here in a cryptographic setting where collisions are super dangerous, yeah, like the SHA-1 problem that occurred in the last week. In machine learning, this just means that two features map to the same dimension. OK, maybe you cannot discriminate them then. Maybe you lose information. But if you have thousands of features, who cares if two collide? I mean, maybe they're the most important ones. But you can also compute, due to the uniform distribution of hash function, the chances that your most important features collide are not so high, right? So feature hashing is the tool to deal with this problem. So here's an example of what we did a couple of years ago. I already told you about this parser for HTTP requests. In this example, we then just analyzed all the possible subtrees in these requests and then had a huge feature space. And there was a one if a certain subtree occurred. And if a certain subtree did not occur, we had a zero in our feature space. OK. So did this help you, this short feature session? Partially, right? OK. So maybe I just needed to do this because I just wanted to give you some examples of what we did. Whether this fits your needs, you have to see it yourself. But in principle, maybe summarizing these slides, you have two options. You can either, you have two options. Either you go for the first variant, numerical features. Think about normalization, but this is pretty straightforward. Or you go for the back of something approach, which can be directly applied to anything sequential. And if you have structured data, my recommendation is don't waste your time with analyzing the structure too much. Maybe you learn something about the data yourself. But in principle, feature hashing is a very good approach to solve this quickly. OK, then we jump quickly. Zack. Yeah. Yeah, so it's a very good question. So for example, I could express the number of non-printable characters also as a ratio of the length. Yeah, I could say 10% is non-printable, 90% is printable. And then I theoretically could drop a feature. I could save it. Now, I would not do this. And the reason is that each of these features that I picked, I have a feeling that they are useful for spotting attacks. So for example, if there's a buffer overflow in some part of my web service, it might be that I get very long data. So this means the length feature alone is a very good indicator for buffer overflows. The number of non-printable characters might also be a good indicator for somebody sending something encrypted or something, let's say, a shellcode or so. And what else did I add? The number of punctation symbols. The idea here is that if you do something like cross-site scripting or SQL injection, that you will need to add a certain amount of control characters to your input. So for example, you need to encode, for example, spaces and things like that, such that they slip through the processing chain until they reach, for example, the SQL database. This means you will need to use a lot of UI encoding and things like that. So what I'm trying to tell you is all of these features have the potential to spot certain types of attacks. And I would keep all of them, although they are redundant. In general, my advice would be to throw as much into as possible. If you were writing then later an academic paper, I would think about those things that did not work. I would then throw them away and say, OK, this was part of our experimental, so how we learned more about the problem and learned more about the input. But if you're starting from scratch, the first thing I would take is just as much as possible. Of course, if you say you put in the ratio and the absolute number, it also automatically implies that you need to use normalization, because they are definitely on a different scale by their construction. And you once you normalize the data, make sure that the ratio is not equivalent to the absolute numbers, because it could be due to length and things like that. OK, well, then we can talk about classification and understand a little bit about how classification can be applied for detecting attacks. I think this is, from a security perspective, interesting and has been applied very, very often in academia, at least. Yeah. So I once did an analysis, when about 2013 or so. I had a talk at a workshop at CCS, and I wanted in this talk to emphasize that machine learning is in fact used, but people are not really talking about it. And I took all the papers from the major four security conferences and searched for machine learning terms in these papers. And it turned out that in every fourth paper, there were machine learning terms in the text. Well, I didn't do a semantic analysis, so I checked. They could also have written, machine learning is crap. Right? I would also count this on my. But at least every fourth author somehow had the feeling he needs to mention these terms in his paper, whether positive or not. So it seems that there is something in it. On the contrary, if you look into the abstracts and the titles of the paper, there were only very, very few mentioning machine learning terms. So it seems like a lot of people are using it, but not really mentioning it. So, and this can have many reasons. Yes, but at least it's something that people seem to care about. And classification likely is the most used term there, and also the most used technique. I didn't look for classification because it's not, as a term, restricted to machine learning. So what is classification? I said that it's a technique where you would discriminate classes. And if you're thinking about attacks, it would be about discriminating benign and malicious attacks. And it's a classic supervised setting. So this is a recapitulation from the previous session, where you would just try to learn what is the difference between a good and a bad email, or what is the difference between a good and a bad program. Now, here are a couple of problems. So first of all, if you want to do this, you need examples of both classes. And you need sufficient and representative. Otherwise, this will fail. So if you have only one attack, if you only have Stuxnet in your set of super effective APT attacks, and you have a lot of normal data, and you throw a learning algorithm at it, it has to overfit, because it only has one example of this class. So what can it generalize from one instance? Nothing. And if you have two or three instances, still, it is very difficult to generalize from three things. And this is not different from us as humans. So if we only see one tree in our life, we will have a hard time detecting other trees. Yeah? So you need to have representative data. And this is something that is often overlooked, unknown attacks need to be related to known attacks. And this is a very strong assumption. So we are separating a space into two halves. And we want that on one side is a malicious part, and on the other side is a benign part. But all that we know about malicious and benign is what we know today. So we know about the presence. And if we build our model that it captures only the things that are known today, with no option of something being more general, then likely our system will only work as long as the attacks are very similar to what they are today. And once the attacks change completely, we are lost. This is a difficult problem. And the only thing that we can do is we can speculate that attacks, for certain reasons, might look the same also in the future. So for example, we might speculate that a buffer overflow needs to overflow a buffer, and therefore needs to have a certain size, larger than the buffer. Right? So this means length, for example, in this particular setting, might be a feature that persists even in the future, as long as there are buffer overflows. Or if we have some kind of JavaScripting, cross-site scripting attacks, there might be JavaScript code in the attacks to do the scripting. And if we have some features that capture this, this might be useful. On the other hand, if JavaScript is removed from the web and everything is programmed in Dart or Swift or, I don't know, another language that looks completely different, has different keywords, it might be that then our learned decision gets crap. So just be warned. This is, by the way, this is exactly the mistake that Amazon makes with my recommendations. Just because I ordered one Desperate Housewives DVDs doesn't mean that I always order Desperate Housewives DVDs. Right? This is, so their features seem to be overly specific. And I think for their setting, it's OK. But for an attack detection setting, I think this is not sufficient. And then we also have something. It's called a semantic gap. I also talked about this already in the coffee break, by the way. If I learn something, it might be that what I'm learning is not what I actually want to learn. So I discriminate two things. But the learning algorithm sees only the examples that you give the algorithm. And if these examples contain some artifacts of your generation procedure, the learning algorithm will pick these artifacts. And very often, this happens. For example, I give you a political incorrect example. So we did an experiment where we tried to detect malicious communication, or communication that was sent from malicious software. And we used machine learning techniques to model content of this malicious communication. It was not encrypted, so we could look into this communication. And once we applied this in practice at a large university network, we got a lot of false positives. And we were surprised, because we, in our lab setting, these false positives did not occur. So what happened? It happened that there was a student dorm with a lot of Chinese students, and they had a Chinese version of the browser. And the Chinese browser had certain strange-looking Chinese characters sent with all the traffic. And unfortunately, in our data set, we had a lot of Chinese malware. So we were basically, aside from learning good characteristics, we were also learning that if there are too many Chinese characters in some communication, it's malicious. This is an artifact. And it was clear because we were in a German university, and our normal traffic did not include this student dorm and these Chinese students, but instead parts of our own lab. And at that time, there were no Chinese students in our lab. So typical experimental failure. And this can become a problem if you apply this in practice. So if you do this, try to check that your data is representative for both classes, not only the attack, but also for the benign class. If we would have had Chinese students in our training data, then these features would not have been picked, because the learning algorithm could have seen that those features are not useful for discriminating good and bad. It's actually, this example is politically correct, right? It's just maybe that some of you in your heads thought, yeah, maybe, why are is there so many Chinese malware or so? But this is in your heads. I didn't say it. And we also had a lot of other malware from other countries. And also, overfitting to known attacks is, I think this is likely the most common problem. OK, so then the question comes, where do I get attack data from? And I mean, this is far from trivial. So because if you would have a system that can detect attacks, you could use this system in the first place. What we did in the past is we used honeypots. So you have something, systems in your network that do not have a productive purpose, but instead just wait to be attacked. You can do this at all possible levels. And if you're developing software or have some kind of infrastructure, I highly recommend that you think about placing at certain locations non-productive systems whose goal is only to be attacked. If they are never attacked, you lose a little bit of your resources, but that's it. And if they are attacked, you can learn about these attacks. So there are two types of honeypots. Maybe I'm sketching this very quickly. Passive and active. Passive is what I just sketched. You place them somewhere. Maybe you put in Windows 95 somewhere in your network with no patches and see. Yeah? Active means you are actively going to some place to be attacked. So for example, we did this, and I will show you this later. You can go to websites which are really shady and then see whether you get attacked. And my PhD student loved these experiments, where you can go to all these red light web pages during your working hours. There was once they had a computer running in the background in their lab. This was also not politically correct. And it was basically visiting all these pages and displaying the front page for 1 minute. So this was like you were in this room, you were talking, and there were constantly porno sites popping up. But this is like actively looking for being attacked. And of course, we got attacked because shady places are shady places. So of course, you can get attack information from forensic analysis. So this would be in cases where you really have an incident and you have a forensic team in your company and they give you information. Or, which we also used a lot, there are something, security services. So who knows VirusTotal? So VirusTotal is, I would say, a super great, fantastic community service. It's not community anymore. It's owned by Google now. But they run, I think, 50 virus scanners. You can submit files to the service, and then they will apply these 50 virus scanners to the file, and you get feedback from all the 50. Moreover, they run other tools. So for example, they analyze also if this the network communication, if this is an executable file. So they will run it in a sandbox. And they have further add-ons. And this, in our research, it very often helped to get ground truth, or at least to get a feeling whether something is malicious or not. Because if 50 scanners, let's say 40 scanners of 50 marked as malicious, maybe it's malicious. Whereas if only one of 50 scanners says this is malicious, we don't know whether it's malicious or not. OK, so let's take these thoughts and come back to our example. So how do we really learn such a separation that such that one class is on one side and the other class is on the other side? And what I will do is I will go with a support vector machine world. Maybe because I'm from this religious party of the machine learning community. But the main reason is that I think it is a very intuitive model that is, I would say, very good for people to understand how it works. So it has a geometric interpretation. And I think this is this can be far easier to understand as the other models. So let's look at the support vector machine and look at the model that is learned, which is called a hyperplane. Now, hyperplane sounds a little bit overly scientific. It basically is a plane in a high-dimensional vector space. Yeah, so if it's two-dimensional, you would say plane. If it's three-dimensional, you would say hyperplane already. No. Plane, still plane?
Two-dimensional is a line, right?
Is a line, yes, right. Two-dimensional is a line. Three-dimensional is a plane. Four-dimensional is a hyperplane. But as we cannot really imagine more than three dimensions, I think everybody has in its head a plane. And this is the learning model of a support vector machine. And in my examples, I will always use the two-dimensional case. So it's basically we are learning a straight line. So how does it work mathematically? Well, you have your feature representation, which is now a vector phi. And you have this line. And maybe most of you know a line can be represented with exactly the dimensions that you need in the vector space. So for example, if you have a line in 2D, then you would need two dimensions to represent it, defining the direction of the plane. Do you remember this from your school mathematics? And do you also remember this inner product trick? So if you multiply or you compute the inner product between a vector and this representation of a line or plane, if it's larger 0, then it's on one side. If it's smaller 0, it's on the other side. This is, yes. That's basically the idea. And this makes the whole implementation extremely simple. So you get a new point, you compute the feature vector, you compute this inner product, and then you just need to run a sine function, which basically tells you whether it's smaller or larger than 0. That's it. Are you still with me? Okay, so this algorithm, the support vector machine, implements this concept. The first idea came from the 60s and in good old Russia. And it took some time to propagate to the United States. In fact, Vladimir Vapnik, who had this idea, need to travel to the Bell Labs from AT&T to bring this idea there, because all of the publications were written in Russian. And I only know this because the postdoc that was supervising me when I was a PhD student, he was from Russia, and he had read all the papers. And he told me that these ideas are pretty old, like from the 60s, whereas the Western community or the English-speaking world learned about this in the 90s. Yeah, so this is an interesting observation, in particular if we now look at the United States. So not everything in the States is novel, and sometimes there are also good ideas at other places. Doesn't need to be Russia, but so I mean, we as Europeans can also be proud of what we do, and sometimes it takes 30 years for a good idea to propagate to some place. As I said in the first session, the idea is to separate the data with maximum margin. So this means I'm placing the plane between the classes and have it directly in the middle. And there's some concept known as softening, which I will talk shortly about, which is about making the hyperplane more like a rubber band. So if there are some wrong classifications, it can be scratched a little bit. Yeah, so it's not like a stick or something which is rigid, but it can be bended a little bit, softened. And this will help us to make the decision even in cases where there are mistakes in our data. So let's look at this example. So this is more or less the same picture as in the previous example. The only difference now is that the line here has a maximum margin. And in case you are applying this later in practice, there are points which are on the margin. So and these points are called support vectors. And this is where the name from this algorithm comes from. So if you think about a margin, it always means that there are points on the border of the margin. If there are no points on the border of the margin, you can make the margin a little bit bigger, and then you will reach points. So there are always points at the margin. And they are called support vectors, and they somehow define how this hyperplane looks. And the formula here is the same, but you don't need to care about this. So but what happens now, and this is one of the main inventions of the hyperplane, of the support vector machine, what happens if you have points on the wrong side? And previously, many algorithms failed in this example. Because they were iteratively processing over the data, and then they would move into a state where they would alternating between different learning models. So if they would see this point, they would say, OK, the line needs to be here. But once they see this point, they would then flip it back again. And then they would alternate back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. And you would not get a good solution. And the cool idea of the hyperplane is that I'm skipping all the, I removed all the formulas, so you just get these without any explanation about the variables. So I try to explain. What the idea is that you have this kind of, it's called a xi here at the end. And it basically says it needs to be on the plus one side or on the minus one side. But I allow it with this xi to be slightly off. Look here, it's plus 1 minus xi, and there it's minus 1 plus xi. So it's exactly in the other direction. And during the optimization problem, which I'm not showing, the learning algorithm tries to find a solution that separates the data and has a small xi over all the different xi's. But it allows, for some points, these xi also to be large. And this is exactly what I described in the beginning. This is this rubber feeling that there might be one point peeking through the hyperplane, and it's exactly on the opposite side. Then it has a very large xi. But if all other points have a very small xi in sum, this is the best solution. Did you get this? Yes, not error, but distance from the right side. Yes, so it's not. Usually, and this is also part of my longer series. Usually, I torture the students by looking exactly at the optimization problem, and if you do this, it becomes also very clear how it works. But for this session, I skipped it, so I'm a little bit not super happy because. Instead of presenting these formulas, I could have drawn this rubber surface. Maybe this would be better in terms of didactic. But that's how it is. You have to live with it. OK, but for the kernel functions, I talked about these functions that I used to map the data into a different space. I have a picture, and there's no formulas. So I did, in this case, I did it right. So here you see two classes, green and red. And they are separated using a support vector machine. The hyperplane is somewhere here. And now I apply this kernel trick, so this technique of mapping the data to an infinite dimensional, super complex, very fancy feature space. And I also learn the hyperplane in this space. And then what this coloring here is, I map the resulting surface back into the two-dimensional world to visualize what has been learned. And here you see two common kernel functions, polynomial kernel and Gaussian kernel. And if you look at them, you can see that the decision surface now becomes very bumpy and can model the data with different complexity, although in the actual induced space, only a hyperplane has been learned. Yeah? And most implementations just have a parameter where you can plug this in. Usually there's also a number which you can tune. And then you get these fancy representations without changing the learning setting. So some words about implementations. If you want to work with support vector machines, I recommend this because I'm my personal favorite. But you can, of course, go and search other algorithms. But my personal favorite implementations for support vector machines are both from Taiwan. Which is libSVM and liblinear, they are extremely good, in my opinion. They are both written in C++. The code is a nightmare. But libSVM implements two class and one class SVMs in various flavors. It supports different kernel functions. You can just change them with a command line parameter. So what we usually do is we have a simple for loop, and it goes through all the kernels and all these parameters. Runs for a half a day, and then you have a first estimate of what would be a good setting. Remember the thing about the holdout data set, right? What you then have is not your final result. Likely you have somehow overfitted or have somehow tortured the data so long that it confesses to your labels. But this is it's very easy and a good start. And even better is liblinear, which is a support vector machine implementation without kernels. So it really learns just the plane. Super simple. It's super fast. And it can learn with millions of samples and millions of features. And I'm not kidding. Yeah? So we have plugged in about 5 million data points with 300,000 dimensions each. Sparse, of course. And this learns a hyperplane in about 5 minutes. So as long as you can get the data into memory, or the vectors into memory, this works very well. So highly recommended. They have a lot of examples, and I think it's amazing that this group from Taiwan is so productive in producing such useful tools. And the machine learning community is also using them a lot. So it's like the standard for support vector machines. If you use some toolboxes, so Hulo, SkyKit Learn, those are the implementations in SkyKit Learn. So you don't need to, actually you're using this already if you stick to these methods. So then I have a black hat slide, which is always necessary. And we talked about this already, but I like to add it again. So if we apply this exactly as I said, we might run into problems. And we run in particular into problems if the data that we get is not fully under our control. Here I have sketched three typical attacks against machine learning systems. The first one is poisoning. So this means I carefully inject malicious or benign data into the training data such that the classifier will generate a wrong decision. So for example, I can add benign data to my attacks. So I could add the term faculty club to my attacks. This would mean either that my attacks are not detected anymore because now they contain a benign term, or that everything that contains faculty club is also marked as malicious. So I have two advantages. Either I'm missed, or I manage to get other data points flagged as attacks which are not attacks. Powerful. Then, which is called mimicry, I could also try to model my attack such that it looks like normal data. There's a cool paper from 2009 or 10 called English Shellcode. Does somebody know this paper? It's a paper where they construct machine code. So it's machine code that you can put directly onto the CPU of a computer. But the machine code is constructed only of English words. There is no binary, nasty punctuation symbols in it. It's just English text. It's an English text that you can compute or that you can put into a CPU, and it will run because it's only instructions from the CPU. This is a very, very cool example of a mimicry attack. And of course, it's extremely difficult to attack because many features, and we talked about this, will not trigger on this because it's natural text or it looks like natural text. And then my favorite is the red herring attack. It's also the most stupid attack, but it's unfortunately very effective. If you have a learning system in place, you can also generate fake attacks as preparation for your final attack. So instead of launching your final attack at the first day, you send every hour 10 to 20 fake attacks where you know that they will be detected by the system. This means that the administrator needs to look at all these false alarms, and at some point, he will shut the system off or not look at the alarms at all. So who knows the intrusion detection system Snort? So it's an open source intrusion detection system. There's a tool called Sneeze. It loads the signatures from Snort and then can generate network packets where each network packet matches one signature. And if you send this data to an intrusion detection system using Snort, or a company using Snort, you can be sure that each of your packet triggers an alert. Now, if you send out 1,000 packets per second, you can be sure you have thousands of alerts per second. Renders the system ineffective. And I also must admit that there are no trivial solutions to this problem. So the solution would be to improve the feature representation and get away from flat, simple strings to more sophisticated semantic stuff, which cannot be forged easily. OK, so then I have a half an hour left, right? Yep, very good. Then I decided maybe to open the discussion to present one case study, which is something that we really did and where I go through all the stages, but now in a more concrete, even more concrete setting. It's a paper from 2010, so it's also a little bit old, but I think many of the ideas and concepts now come to a very concrete setting. And also, if this is called secappdev, I thought maybe also there need to be some slides where there's code on it, right? I have one slide where it's code. No, it's two slides. Okay, so this is about a system that we built for detecting drive-by downloads in 2010. So drive-by downloads are still a topic. The way the attackers proceed has slightly changed, but the overall story has remained the same. You browse through a website, and when you request a certain web page there, you not only retrieve the web page and benign malicious code, but benign JavaScript code, but you also receive malicious JavaScript code, which, for example, has been injected either from the outside or by even compromising the server running this web page. Yeah, so think of this of some kind of malicious JavaScript code present in some fields in a database or other parts of the web page. And once you do this, the JavaScript code is downloaded to your client. And in the browser, something I would say very unfortunate happens. The JavaScript code can actively look for vulnerabilities in your browser environment. So it's a deviation from classic attacks, where you would just shoot one exploit at the victim and see what happens. Here we have an environment where the attacker can programmatically look for problems. So usually, these drive-by downloads come with a set of exploits for different versions of Internet Explorer or Firefox or Chrome. And then they test them one by one until they find a weak spot in your particular browser. And then, once they gain control over it, they will download further malicious software and compromise your system. The reason is that we somehow allowed third parties to submit code to our browser. And I think this is, I tell this my students, so if I go to a very popular German newspaper, Bild, I'm not sure if you know this, but it's, you shouldn't. They send about 1 megabyte of JavaScript code to my browser and then execute it. And I just have to accept this. I mean, I can also block it, but then the site doesn't work anymore. But if somebody of you would send me an email with 1 megabyte of code and tell me, please execute this, I would say, no, never. But when it comes to web pages, we are very open, and every day we execute thousands of malicious code. So here's an example to illustrate that this is, in fact, also a technically difficult problem. So here you see, it should be aligned. Here you see some drive-by download attack. They used some very weird obfuscation technique, which is not very sophisticated. But on the top, you see the code from Google Analytics. And just as a human, I would say there's not much difference in terms of these representations between the benign and the bad world. This was one of the reasons that we said, well, this is a perfect setting for machine learning, because we know there are, of course, semantics inside these representations. But for a human, it will take very long to understand what this is. And maybe a machine learning algorithm can just identify certain things and pick them out and use them to make a decision. So therefore, we built a system that is implemented in a proxy. So this is the proxy here. And the proxy will inspect all web pages that you access. And it will perform two analysis chains, one using dynamic analysis and one using static analysis. Dynamic analysis means we're running the JavaScript code in a sandbox. So we're looking what's happening if the code is executed. Static analysis means we're looking how at the structure and the overall look of the code without executing it. Then we do some feature extraction. I'll come to this in a moment. And then we do some detection. And I guess you know all of the techniques that we used. So I will then just name them, and you will see, this is what they used. And in the end, we look at both the static and dynamic detection. And if there's some of these JavaScript codes falls onto the malicious side of our support vector machine, we will block the transmission of this data. So talking about the static analysis first, as I said, yeah?
So did you use one learner for each, or did you use one learner for both?
We used two learnings. So we had two support vector machines. Okay. Yeah. Okay, so for the static analysis, so this is the reason I'm showing it. So here you should get a feeling what you can do to engineer features. So for the static analysis, we want to get an impression of how does the code look. And we could have done many different techniques, but we decided to stick to a simple approach. So what we did is just lexicalically analyzing the JavaScript code. So not extracting the full syntax tree, but instead just parsing the different tokens and then replacing them with certain symbols. So for example, ID here means this is an identifier, this is a string, this is a numeric constant. Those symbols are part of the keywords for, and so on and so forth. The only identifier that we did not replace was eval, because it's so important in JavaScript attacks. It allows the attacker to execute code that he has assembled himself. And although this is not a super smart representation, there are already some things that we can see. For example, we can see there's string arithmetics here. And there's a very typical loop which does something and then executes the outcome of the loop. And if you look more closely on the example, you will see this is obfuscated JavaScript code. The actual code is hidden in this nasty string there. The string contains something. And the loop is only used to decrypt it. And I'm showing this because it illustrates that if you use static analysis, you can see something like loops and arithmetics, but you cannot see everything in a language like JavaScript, because some parts might only be unpacked during runtime. And this is why we use the second analysis chain. And in this case, we would use what I would call a lazy browser evaluation. Lazy means, so if you execute JavaScript code, the JavaScript code will interface with the browser. So it will look for something like the DOM tree, and it will look for certain parts of the browser. Of course, if you're in a proxy, you don't have a browser. So what we implemented, this is why it's lazy, is a JavaScript engine that basically has all possible objects available. So if you say, give me object Löwen, it will say, here's object Löwen. And if you say run method, I don't know, secappdev on object Löwen, the engine will say, yes, works, true. So basically, everything that the script tries to do, which is not implemented by our engine, will be faked. And everything that we implemented, of course, will perform as expected. So this allowed us to do some kind of lightweight dynamic analysis. And if we take the example from the previous page, this here, and run it in this sandbox, it will be unpacked. And we can finally see the JavaScript code that was hidden in this string. And it's, if you're curious what this does, it constructs a NOPSLET, which is a typical part of a shell code for exploiting vulnerabilities. So then, and now comes the easy part for this session, we did feature extraction, and you know already how this worked. We took the string approach, so we took the reports from the static and the dynamic analysis and just extracted snippets with overlap of length 3. So here, this would be set E2, E20. And then we constructed a feature space exactly as I explained, where there's like several thousands of dimensions. But one JavaScript only has a few of these dimensions with non-zero values. And we did this for the static as well as the dynamic part, simply because you can apply this simple idea of extracting snippets to all forms of strings. So it didn't matter whether the strings were lexically parsed JavaScript code or the output of a sandbox. And if we would have had a third analysis engine with some other output, we would have also put this into a string representation and use exactly this approach. And for the classification, well, I do not need to tell you what this is. We use the support vector machine exactly as I explained. We even used liblinear straight out of the box and learned a separation. So how did this perform in practice? So for training, we had two problems. So we needed representative data from both classes. Getting benign web pages is more or less easy. More or less, because ground truth. So what we did is we picked the 200 top web pages from the Alexa ranking. And we assumed that most of them are benign. We checked with common blacklists to find something malicious and removed, I think, 4 or 5 instances which were known to host malicious examples. But overall, we treated all of these web pages as benign. And we could do this because we know that the support vector machine can cope with some mislabeled instances due to this regularization and the softened hyperplane. This is why I explained this in the beginning. So if your data is not perfectly labeled, this is not a showstopper for most learning methods. It's for many reviewers, this is a showstopper, because they say, oh, if the data is not perfectly labeled, how can you then learn something? This is the wrong idea about how learning works. Learning is not memorization. Learning is about generalizing, and generalizing can be done even if some instances are wrong. The same holds, by the way, also for humans. We also don't get always consistent input to our learning system. So some of these examples might be on the wrong side, but the feeling was that it's less than a couple of instances. And fortunately, we asked the guys from Santa Barbara, who at that time had a community service called Vepavet. I'm not sure if it's still running, which was a community site where researchers could submit attacks and then have these attacks analyzed and learn about the inner workings of the attacks. And of course, the Santa Barbara guys were very clever, so they collected, of course, all these submitted attacks. And in principle, the service was dual use. One use was for the community. The other use was collecting a sufficient set of malicious code. And they shared this set with us, so we could use this data set, split it into 2 parts, one for training, one for testing, and then run machine learning experiments. So this is the outcome. Our system is called Cujo. By the way, who knows the movie Cujo? Okay. Or the book. I'm always asking this, but I don't know the book, but the movie, I think it's an interesting movie, especially if you like dogs. Anyway, so we called this Cujo, and it turned out that our system performed very well in comparison to 2 virus scanners that we had available at that time. So one is ClemAV. So who knows ClemAV? ClemAV is not the best virus scanner, right? It's a community open source implementation, and we were not surprised that it didn't work. But Antivir is a German security company, and the company is called Avira, but their product is called Antivir. And at that time, they had a specific product called WebGuard, and the task of this product was to detect exactly these attacks. So that's why we put it into our system. And it turned out that it didn't really work as well as our learning-based approach. So we were super happy, and we thought also that we were super smart. But the research community also noticed this problem and also noticed that machine learning might be a good tool. And this was slightly before us, this was after us, but other groups also did something very similar, and they also succeeded. So the result is that we are not super smart. We are smart, but this is a problem that perfectly fits into this machine learning setting, because you can get the data automatically, you can somehow use some kind of code analysis techniques to extract features, and then you can learn a classifier to discriminate benign and malicious JavaScript code. And they did exactly this. The difference, they did it with anomaly detection. So they have a large corpus of normal JavaScript code and detect anything that deviates. It works very well, suspiciously well, I would say. The top one is true positive, which means the detection rate, number of detected attacks. And this is false positive rate, ratio of false alerts. So they can detect all attacks. It's OK. I think maybe it is true. Then this is an implementation from Microsoft. Microsoft put the whole thing into the browser because they could. We couldn't. We had no idea how to do this. And we looked a little bit into the Chrome and Firefox implementation and gave up. It was complicated. Microsoft, of course, could do it. And they implemented the analysis inside their Internet Explorer. And I think they did a very, very good job because they have no false positives in their experiments and still a high detection. So that was cool. And this paper, it's from Ruhr University of Bochum, has a high false positive rate. But aside from this, it uses a very clever trick, which I also like to mention. So JavaScript supports something that is called a frozen object, or the freezing objects, which means these objects are not mutable anymore. They are fixed. And they said, why not put the detection system also as JavaScript in the browser and freeze it before going to a web page? So in this setting, the detector, and also the machine learning detector, is available as JavaScript. It's put into the browser, and then it's frozen. And when you visit a web page, it can analyze the JavaScript code without being manipulated by the JavaScript code of the web page. I think this is a very cool idea. Of course, it had limitations because it operated in a far more difficult setting. And maybe as a personal comment, I think they could have tuned their method in favor of false positives. I think this was just a case where maybe the reason for this session that they were not really aware of all the options that they have with machine learning and just picked one solution, implemented it, and used it. So I think they could tune it likely down in terms of false positive rate by sacrificing a little bit of their detection. OK, so this was the, yeah. Yes. No, I can tell you if you're interested. So
I'm interested to understand how it impacts the precision. So whether you only use static or you do both, or
it's so this paper uses static and dynamic, and they use only numerical features. So they have some kind of for example, they count the number of string arithmetic operations, they check the length of strings and things like that. So they have a manually engineered feature set, which is also described very well in the paper. It's WWW conference 2009, I would say. This is, of course, it's with Ben Lifshitz, and therefore it uses a little bit of more programming language knowledge. So they really extract parse trees. They do this, what I said, is maybe overkill. So they analyze subtrees in the JavaScript parse tree. And they can do it because they're really inside the JavaScript interpreter of the Internet Explorer. So they have access to these parse trees. They are generated anyway. Yeah, so I think this is very sophisticated. And this paper does, I think, a mixture of numerical and sequential features. So they have some keywords that they're looking at. But they also measure certain things like the length or entropy of some strings. In terms of static and dynamic, they don't have a choice because they are somehow inside the browser. So the dynamic analysis is limited. They observe the code as it is executed. So this is, I would say, likely only static because they need to make the decision before the code is run. And the Zozel thing, I think they called it mostly static analysis. So what they do is they do a static analysis of the code. But at runtime, whenever new code is unpacked, they also do a static analysis of the unpacked code. So it's a mixture of static and dynamic. No. I mean, the only problem that we had, and I would do something different. I would try to get it into the browser. We thought about this very long, but we didn't know. Maybe we lacked knowledge of somehow intercepting the code inside the interpreter. We were too stupid to do this. And in a proxy, things are more easy. You somehow get the data in, and then you just parse it and extract it. And but in terms of runtime and also in terms of usability, it would have been better to have it inside the browser. Okay, so brings me to the end. So the second session was a little bit more, I tried to bring it a little bit to one concrete case in the very end, but still a lot of things were left, right? So I hope you can take something away from this particular route that I picked. Maybe the takeaway messages. The first thing is, if you want to apply machine learning in practice, it's very important that you think about the features. And I picked the Kudrow example because we had two different analysis steps that generated features for us, a static and a dynamic analysis of the code. I picked it because it illustrates that it's worth investing time into a good feature design, or it doesn't need to be the features, but in a good analysis step that somehow extracts the important stuff from your data. I didn't show this, but the static and dynamic analysis alone are not sufficient to get these results. So it's really having the view on both sides, yeah, in our setting. So it's always good if you want to apply machine learning to think about features longer and also think about pre-processing steps, getting more information out of the data that are relevant. So first. Second, if you want to detect something, this was this session was about, you need to decide whether this is an anomaly detection or classification setup. And the answer to this is pretty simple. Can you get both classes equally easy? Or is only one class available and the other is extremely hard to get? If only one class is available, you have to use anomaly detection. Anything else will produce crap because you cannot learn from a few instances. If you have both classes available, don't use anomaly detection, use classification. The methods work very well. There's even a proof. So you could use two anomaly detectors, one for the good class and one for the bad class, right? And then you could somehow use anomaly detection as classification. And there's a nice paper that shows that if you do this with hyperspheres, also with balls, that this automatically converges to a hyperplane. And that this hyperplane, if these spheres have certain properties, is a maximum margin hyperplane. So in other terms, learning a classification function is the same as learning two anomaly detection methods in certain settings. Put the other way around, don't waste the time with learning two models, learn one model, this is sufficient. Okay, so then we have now a little bit more time of question than expected. Yeah. So this is the problem of ground truth. First of all, it exists exactly as you say, and it has two implications. And one implication is easy, and the other is hard. So easy is if your data set is not perfectly labeled. For those algorithms that I presented here, and also for many other, including deep learning, random forests, mislabeled examples are not a problem. So if, let's say, 1% of your data is mislabeled, this is really not a problem. So the learning works. The problem is on the scientific side. You, at the very end, want to present something like a detection rate and a false positive rate. And the mislabels, they don't play into your cards. So you, as a researcher, have the problem of showing that the algorithm could learn something from the mislabeled data. And this is something that is not easy to fix, especially if you have 10,000 or 100,000 of samples, and there is maybe 1% mislabeled. This could mean that you have automatically 1% false positive rate, which is the false positive rate. So what many researchers do is manually investigate false positives as long as it gets too tedious, and try to find out, is this really a misprediction of the learning algorithm? Is it really wrong? Or is it a wrong label? So this is what we, for example, did and do. And in many cases, the learning algorithms make errors. And they make errors because of artifacts. So this is what I said in the middle of this talk. So because the learning setup is not perfect, we have learned some artifacts like Chinese characters or things like that. And investigating false positives and false negatives, those instances which are wrongly classified, often helps to identify the artifacts and then improve the experimental setting. Yes, that's right. The question is how, let's say, yes. In principle, you need to look at all four cases, which is true positive, false positive, true negative, false negative. However, usually you tune these methods into one direction. Usually we tune the methods in such that the false positive rate is low. And therefore, we only need to check one part of the site because we moved it already so close to the edge that many benign things are marked as false positive. So we just need to find out whether the things are here okay. We don't need to care for this site. This is, of course, a pragmatic way. In theory, it could be that there's an attack which is totally off and we never know. And this is maybe what somebody from the NSA would be here. He would say, yes, our attacks are so far away from all other attacks, and they are always missed, that in your learning world, they always are on the wrong side, and you will never know. Yeah.
But no other human being knows.
Yes, exactly. This is the story, right? So if you're capable of making the attacks extremely rare and extremely sophisticated, nobody, neither a machine nor a human knows about their existence. And then strategically, I would also say maybe you can just claim that these exist, that this attack exists and don't make them. I would do this, for example. I would say, yes, we have this super smart attack, but you don't know it.
But that's probably a
passive attack. In any case, it's very hard to speculate about the things that you don't know. You had a question. That's a very good question. So in principle, I can talk for my group. We are very open. So we have some large data sets available from our papers, which are used by many researchers. But there is a problem in the security community or machine learning community. And it's hard to describe. So in the 90s, there was a large competition called the DARPA Intrusion Detection Evaluation Competition. And they published a large data set for training machine learning. This was the goal. And a lot of people did it, and it was very successful, and everybody liked it. This was 1999. And then machine learning people started to abuse this data set as yet another application. So they would just design some learning method and then apply it to this data without knowing what's inside the data and without knowing what this data set is about. And they abused it so much that security people were really annoyed of this. I'm really annoyed. So there exist tons of papers that just take this data set from the 90s, apply it, have false positive rate of, 20%, and write, we are exceptionally great, and blah, blah. So they have some kind of wrong, the first attempt of making this public somehow failed, due to the communities not working together, but just abusing the data from the community for their own purposes without reflecting on the problems of the other community. But in the long run, I think data sets will become more public, and also models will become public and shared. I mean, there's no reason not to do this.
Even if I don't have the same data as you, but we have used similar methodologies, can be somehow combined in neural networks or support vector machine in some clever way, so we kind of gradually both increase the...
Yes. Yes, for sure. I mean, also, what is interesting is if you have a similar setting, but you use a different learning method, we could just take the data that you classify and what I classify and put it next to each other and see where do the methods differ in their decision. and not to term, to decide which method is the best. This was what machine learning people would do, but to find out what are the interesting cases where the learning methods somehow do not agree. Likely, this is an interesting case in terms of security, because something happens that the one side says is this and the other side says that. If there are no further questions, then we are just 55 seconds behind.
Thank you very much.
Okay, so.